I hear nothing. Are we on in there? Hey, thanks, guys. Who was that? Was that them? Was that them or was that you?
No, that was them.
All right. Thanks a lot. Just because there's no crossover. Screwed up my whole open. Matter of fact, the shaft open doesn't even make any sense now. He's going to play something over it. He's going to play Bushy. He's talking about wiretapping. That's all right. Give us time to eat the bagel. So there's totally the reason for the shaft open with the long-ass ramp going up. So.
Who be the man who never circumcised his gland?
Judge!
Stinkadinkie.
Who's the man who talks about all the swinger clubs in town?
Judge!
Right on. He's better than hearing a tape while Neil's away.
What the fuck?
He ain't talking about sports.
Oh, shit!
Jorge be the man who desires to conquer your woman.
Such a spirit.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, your high priest of the Church of Bacchus.
That son of a bitch, what kind of sick weirdo is he?
Oh, he's a little guy, kind of funny looking.
I heard that.
Dick was hunting for quail, drinking Jenny Cream Ale with his pals in Corpus Christi. But when Dick cocked his gun, half-blinded by the sun, he shot his buddy Harry. Now he's got a heartache because of his mistake. Says it was the worst day of his life. Had I bet if Dick could choose again, he'd wish he shot Clinton's wife. Well, Cheney's sick of Dems and Zealots. It was only 300 less zealots that killed his friend.
Oh, nice.
What's going on here?
Everything. All I did was switch. Well, I was playing that off the computer, and I switched screens, and there it went. Should I start it over or just forget about it?
We're
not even done with our bagel. I'm starting it over.
Good call.
Was that good? Besides, I really, really dig the lyrics like we were just discussing.
Dick was hunting for quail, drinking Jenny Cream Ale with his pals in Corpus Christi. But when Dick cocked his gun, half blinded by the sun, he shot his buddy Harry. Now he's got a heartache because of his mistake. Says it was the worst day of his life. Had I bet if Dick could choose again, he'd wish he shot Clinton's wife. Well, Cheney's sick of Dems and Zealots. It was only 300 left. When Dick's got a gun, you should hide behind trees, or your chest will look like imported Swiss cheese, and it's blood you'll be. Thanks to Dick Cheney.
All right, 10:05, 560 QAM. Neil's on vacation. He'll be back next week, a week from today. We got lots of donuts out there. Notice I steered clear of the glazed donuts. I could eat that whole box of glazed donuts.
I'd like to see that.
I could show you.
Yeah, I'm egging you on.
The rest of the show. Look at that. That whole freaking box. I've done that. When the parents owned a donut shop, I would clear out. You know how when you walk into a donut shop, that each flavor has its own tray, right?
Yeah.
I could eat, and sometimes did eat, the entire tray of the freaking glazed donut.
I don't doubt it.
Now, not that we didn't sample all the other kind, and I like chocolate. We both like chocolate. But that chocolate glaze isn't, I don't know, it isn't right. You know what I mean?
The chocolate glaze?
Anyway, you get it. The chocolate raise, it's good, it's fine, but it isn't like, I don't know, it isn't like the kind of chocolate you get like we got at the Melting Pot, for example.
Well,
not that we want to spend the whole first segment talking about that. I'm still not over that experience. She said, I can't get over the Melting Pot experience for Valentine's Day. Let's just buy a fondue pot. So I did. And
She looked up, like, a recipe, bought something at the store. No, didn't work. I did burn my...
It didn't work?
It did not.
Uh-oh.
Well, I mean, it worked, like, the stuff melted in there, and we were... First of all, we got it too hot. She. By we, I mean she. Got it too hot. I burned my mouth.
Ooh.
I got, a internal mouth blister from a big gob of molten chocolate that I stuck on there. And it didn't taste right. Obviously, they've got their own recipes, and I'm sure they're not going to share. Like, I could call the guy up and say, hey, yo, Bob, how about that cheese recipe that Kristen stirred all up in?
So you weren't just trying the chocolate. You were trying to...
Well, no, we didn't. We do have, and I'm scared now. I'm really scared of trying the fondue cheese. We've got a brick. Remember the cheese guy brought all this cheese over?
Yeah.
One of those bricks of cheese that I took home, and I wasn't even looking at it, is like ready to fondue cheese. Oh, you just melt it up, and there you go. Now, but yeah, right. Now, you think it's going to come out the same way?
No.
I
want to
go
not,
there and just because it's not like the main course isn't good. Of course it is. The sauce stuff that you cook your meat and shrimp in is phenomenal, but I've had good meat and shrimp. It's not quite like that. That's unique because they've got their own, I don't know what the cooking sauce is. You know, you pick it up like the citrus.
Your choice of three, whatever.
Right, yeah. But I've never had anything like that cheese in my life.
So I could just like the appetizer when you
right, yeah. The what passes as the appetizer, but I could just make a meal out of that.
Sure.
Out of that big pot of cheese. Just and you don't, it doesn't really matter what you dip in there. You can just dip your finger in there.
Oh yeah. I'm good with that.
Right. The bread, everything, it was just so phenomenal because by the time you're done you need to be carried out.
You do.
And it doesn't look like a lot, but it just keeps coming and coming.
I mean, it's three courses plus a salad.
Right. So I just want the cheese course and the dessert course. Just so that I don't kill myself. How's that? Do you think we could arrange something like that or something? Right here, just melt it up right here?
Yeah.
On the board, just pour the molten cheese on the board?
That's possible.
We're getting totally away from what we wanted to talk about today. Ricky Williams all day. What do you think?
Okay.
I'm kidding, of course. Obviously, that's what everybody else is talking about. All their high hopes dashed, right?
You know,
wasn't he going to be the savior?
That's right, he was the savior. And now that you've been hanging out with him again, and
yoga and smoking. We've been smoking and going to yoga together. I'm not going to lie. And I've been telling him the whole while, you know, Ricky, just keep to what you really want to do. You got enough money, right? This is what you enjoy. You like getting baked and stretching and doing yoga, doing the downward dog. And if this is what you like doing, then you should just do this. And he listened. I made up that whole story. Right there. That was all made up.
Yeah, and whenever he needs money, he'll go back and play a few games and, you know, maybe just...
I don't know if they're going to let him do that.
No, probably not.
Let's try to do some semblance of a show here eventually. We'll talk about the poll that Neil took over the weekend, and I changed it. I was going to leave it on until it got to 2,000. It's 1,981.
Oh.
But I really wanted to get some votes on this thing. I don't know if I can even do that thing that Neil does. No, not that thing. The one where he switches the poll the night before.
Just so
we can get a big result on
start
it.
Out with some
I mean,
vote,
first
yeah.
of all, I don't care. And second of all, I would rather, I don't know, just do it one day at a time, talk about the poll that's going on right now. Now, we will have to talk about what we're going to do tomorrow for a poll, because in case you haven't noticed by the lame-ass poll that we have on there right now, I have no idea.
You know what?
Hey, Sean, where are you for me, Sean? Come on. It's your show. Just because Neil isn't here, help me out with some poll ideas. The reason that I took this thing on the Olympics is because I tried to watch something this morning on TV that wasn't Olympics related, and I couldn't find any. Now, I know to avoid Channel 6, NBC has got the Olympic contract.
Obviously.
So just don't go anywhere near it because Olympics, Olympics, Olympics. And I voted, I don't care, really and truly. Do you?
You know, I've tried watching a little bit this year. And I've noticed how incredibly boring the Winter Olympics
are. Sure.
I actually do like the summer games. I like track and field.
Which ones?
Now, you know.
I'm moderately interested. Maybe this sounds wrong. I want America to win, but
sure.
I don't want to watch it.
Does that make any sense? Well, yeah. You're not.
And
I'm
especially
saying,
the track and field stuff, because that's what I did.
For me,
when
I like to watch sports, right. You know, for entertainment. But the winter, I mean, the game, like, I've turned it on. It's either curling, figure skating,
yeah,
or women's hockey. Listen, I'm all set.
And figure skating is like, that's not a sport, that's a play, that's an event. I went to the Ice Capades when I lived in the Northwest. My girlfriend's family, they had money. They took me to the Ice Capades, you know, where people skate around in costumes and do tricks.
Okay.
Okay? And we had some good seats, and it was interesting. It was a show.
It's like a one-time thing.
Now, what is different between that and what they're doing out there, the figure skating for competition?
They get medals that look like Cheerios now.
Dude, they look like CDs that are hollowed out. They look like somebody took and widened a hole on a CD, spray-painted it gold. Are those the cheesiest? Wasn't it? Didn't I point that out on Friday when I called you in here and I said, hey, check out the medals this year. Oh. Is this the gayest thing you've ever seen or what?
They're just bad.
As a matter of fact, speaking of gay, that hole seems about the right size. I don't know about you. I don't know how you measure up, but I think if you give me one of those gold medals, I know where to hang it. Those are the dorkiest looking medals I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
They look like those coins that Pacific Islanders use for money that they carve out of rock.
Yeah.
You know?
I see Cheerios when I see them.
Yeah.
They look like Cheerios. Like big, just bad.
Dorky looking Cheerios. So we got the poll on here, 260 votes. If we come up with a better poll idea, we might change this today. Or start building something that we can change tonight. I don't know. I haven't even decided that yet. And the weekend poll on the which movie had a bad ending, I'm going to save and savor this throughout the course of the show because we have a lot of material that we could possibly cover. Nothing for the rest of the week, just Monday. And I don't even know if we're going to get any participation today. It's kind of a holiday.
Well, I think officially it is.
Officially?
President,
you know, what's funny is we got a choice which day off we wanted to take, either Martin Luther King Day or today, President's Day, and Neil said, I'm going to take Martin Luther King Day, and I said, it's all right if I take President's Day off, and he said, yeah, okay, no problem, cool. Of course, it happens to fall on a vacation day, so I can't take today off.
Well, hey, don't feel bad, because I work on both days.
Right? Now, do you get holiday pay?
I sure hope so.
Are you going to, like, you write in a timesheet, you going to write in for that?
I do, yeah.
See, some of us are salary, so it doesn't even matter.
Like, you know, just give them a little tip on the timesheet.
Holiday. So let me go over some of these results just so you see how it's going so far. How much do you care about the Olympics? Not at all, 96. A little, 84. Somewhat, 45. Somewhat is the medium choice. All right? Do the thing with your hand, medium choice. 45 people said that. I only care about the Summer Olympics, 14. What are the Olympics, 13. I hate this poll, 9. And a lot, only 6. Only 6 people like it a lot. Like those people that travel out there and buy those really expensive tickets to sit and watch the thing that you're complaining about being boring.
I mean, if anybody can literally call, and I'm not the only person saying this. I mean, these games are just hurt.
Well, I was trying to watch any of it, and
what entertainment value is there? I mean, you're watching,
especially
like
the men's. I was watching the men's speed skating, and we were talking about auto racing this morning with your girl. By the way, thank you, Natasha, for bringing in the bagels and the coffee.
Yeah,
strong by her. Didn't charge me any money.
Don't worry, I'll get charged later.
Yeah, well, good. Better you than me. I mean, I got my own charges pending when I get home. Speaking of that, if anybody wants to think about how to answer this question, getting your wife to think you're cheating. If anybody knows how to get your wife to think you're cheating, because coming home and saying, hey, honey, I'm having an affair. What do you think about that? That doesn't work. She laughs. She just laughs and goes,
she knows you're goofing with her.
Yeah, right. You. Huh? That's funny. I know you can't even afford a hooker, so she knows I'm lying. So what can I do, like, and I thought about this, but then I immediately thought, not, like, get some cheap women's cologne or something and spray that on you.
Start having women call the house.
She's going to accuse me of just, you know, kissing an old lady or my aunt or something like that.
What about the women
calling
the house?
She knows I work with Cuban women, and Cuban women wear a lot of perfume and kiss, so that wouldn't even fly. It's like, yeah, you kiss one of your coworkers, big deal. You ain't fooling me, little man. So think about that. I mean, something like, should I buy some underwear and, I don't know, like, stick them in my pocket?
Like, well, just say, oops, they fell out.
But that wouldn't make any sense because why would I be saving somebody's underwear?
Right.
I never understood that at all. There are people that do that. So that's it. Neil's on vacation. We're going to kill the show. We got movie stuff to talk about, S.H.I.E.L.D. stuff to talk about that has been so rich and creamy this season. I don't know where it's going. Oh, Mackie, how are you going to get out of this one? You know, that kind of thing. Isn't that funny? Mackie is the bad cop. Forrest Whitaker, the IED, Internal Affairs, IAD agent, he's the good guy. He wants to go in there and clean up the shop. Mackie's crooked. He's a murderer. We know that, right? But we're rooting for him.
Well,
what does that
man
say about us? He's the man. He's our anti-hero. We like him a lot. And we want Forrest Whitaker to crash and burn.
Right.
And by the way, how stupid is Mackie's wife? I know it's part of the script. It's part of the drama. It's got to happen that way. But how stupid is she? We'll talk about that. We'll talk about lots of things. Well, I don't know. I don't expect any audience participation today. If you're out there, please, good God, help us. Bail us out. 10:15 on 560 QAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
My floppy last night.
Covered. Oh. Just covered with dust.
What's the one event you want to see on the Olympics on TV?
I'm going to watch those jumps. Watch those jumps on the ski jump. Ski jump, ski jump. Ski jump, ski jump, ski jump. Ski jump, ski jump, ski jump. Try not to hit no bump or you're out. All these guys are wacky. Their outfits are so tacky. Flying through the cold air. Trying to win some gold there. None of them are squeamish and most of them are Swedish. There's a bunch from Norway, but none from the USA. When they land, they're crouching. If they fall, they're ouching. They hope they don't wipe out, cause if they do, it's lights out. I don't mean to be hating. It sure be figure skating. If they don't stay on their feet, the agony of defeat. I love, I love, I love, I love. I love to watch ski jump. Ski jump, ski jump, ski jump. Ski jumps, I love you.
These guys are all nuts.
Ooh, sliding down that icy mountain and style points are counting.
Landing on their butts.
Ooh, sliding down that icy mountain, that mountain, that mountain.
Now the snowboarding thing. I'm moderately interested in that, but
that's fine.
I want to do that. We should arrange a trip where we all
go
snowboarding.
I got to tell you that I tried snowboarding one time, and it's not very easy.
No, I don't imagine it would be. Now, how good are you at skateboarding, though?
Marginal.
Although,
the thing is I'm a hell of a skier, so it doesn't make
sense. Okay, but it's a little different, though.
Like, my first day taking my lesson, I was on pro courses by the end of the day.
Me too. How about that?
Yeah.
My first day
the black
skiing.
Course.
I went from Bunny Hill to the Advanced Hill. 1, 2, 3.
Man, I put that snowboard on though.
Well, see, that's the thing. You know, I'm a little guy and I'm wimpy, and I'm going to get into that because we're talking about cops a little bit later on. And mm-hmm. I'm a wimpy little guy, but when it comes to dexterity things, like staying upright, you know,
right.
I got that down. The skating, the skateboarding. That's why I want to try the snowboarding. I just missed it, man. Like, I left the Northwest the month that everybody was showing up with snowboards.
Oh.
Now, we used to go sledding down the hill on all kinds of things. Now, have you ever seen those little red sled thingies? They look like little tubs, shallow little tubs with
little
handles on the side. That was my weapon of choice.
That's
and
cool.
I would go down the hill any which way, including standing up on that, as long as it wasn't a crazy, crazy hill. And yeah, of course, we would crash and burn. That was
part of the fun.
And people would bring their skis, and every once in a while, they would let you borrow them if they were your size. But that's all fun to do kind of stuff. The same thing applies to the Olympics as to any other sport, at least as far as I'm concerned. Every time I see somebody doing something and it looks fun, I'm not having a good time. I'm getting frustrated.
Yeah, you're getting mad.
Yeah, it's like, that looks like fun. I'm not doing it, and they are.
Ah!
So I got to change the channel, because what's the point of that? It's like same reason that you're not watching, you know, well, that I'm not watching porno. Besides, all of us, you know, you see this girl, and she looks good, and you start thinking things about her and you and her and things that you could be doing together, and then Ron Jeremy shows up and touches her. Right?
He does a little more than that.
I know, a little more. There it goes. She's off the list immediately. So I don't get that. We will talk about the cop thing eventually, but I don't want the guy that got killed and they just had the memorial service on the side of the road.
Right.
Let me ask you a question just out of curiosity, and
please do.
You know, not that I want to piss the cops off again. I always do. When I first heard that story, officer killed in the line of duty, I thought he got shot. Did you have that reaction, or how did
you hear? Well, only because I read it on the Sentinel.com.
And so did everybody I know we were talking about.
I wound up, the headline was very
explanatory. And then I hear, oh no, some dill hole ran off the road and killed him while he was giving somebody a ticket on the road. And then my reaction was, and I asked a couple other people, wife and friends, and I asked them other people, and they concur. My reaction was like, okay, I see, okay. I guess that's line of duty. Sure. Okay. I see that. You know what I mean? It's like,
you know, giving people a ticket, that's duty.
I know.
I'd say that's 90% of their duty.
That's not what I assigned them to do that day. You know, I because, you know, we're their bosses. I know they don't like to be reminded about that, and they'll hit us in the head with a billy bat, or they'll call up and, you know, get all angry and testosterone charged at us for having the nerve to have an opinion about what our employees should be doing with the money that we pay them to protect us. You know, and speed traps ain't one of them. I don't know if that was a speed trap. Let's just give them the benefit of the doubt. I don't know how that whole thing went down.
Sure it was.
You know, and people, oh, sour grapes, George, you get speeding tickets all the time. Yes, I do, too, last year. Thank you, Randy Maltash at the Ticket Defense Team, 1-800-741-TEAM, with whom I would be lost if not for them. And both the tickets that I got, I was going with the flow with everybody else, and they pulled up, you know, I got pulled over in a clump with a whole bunch of other people. En masse, which is very much like these canned hunts that the vice president goes on. Oh, by the way, we got lots of bits about that. We got some catching up to do with that whole canned hunt business, and we'll be talking about that too. What a dill.
Which, by the way, that last bit you played,
in case you haven't noticed, that was a pretty good bit. Yeah. We'll be catching up. We got some bits that fell through the cracks. Catch up on that. Since we can't say any words anymore, I'm going to use dill. I don't know if you've noticed that.
What the dill?
Instead of ass. Like, you can say dill hole for the time being. I don't have no idea what that means, but you get it.
Beavis and Butthead.
You've heard that before, right? Yeah, you dill hole. I don't understand that, but whatever. You like dill pickles?
Sure.
All right. You'll eat a whole pickle? A whole dill? So that was just my reaction to that. And I don't know if it was a speed trap kind of thing, if he was running radar, if he was off the side of the road running
radar. Wasn't it on 594?
See, I'm going to pretend, yeah. I'm going to pretend that he was driving down the road on the way to doing some cop business, real cop business, like looking for some bad people that did some bad things, like stole something or killed somebody or raped somebody, you know, crime. And on the way to doing some crime fighting, somebody sped past him, and so he was compelled to pull them over because that's what this deal did. He ran past him. I'm just going to pretend that was the scenario, all right, so that I can continue to feel sympathetic. And I do feel sympathetic for whatever reason. You know, if I'm with the family in the car, and we get a flat tire, like I did last week. Well, mm-hmm. I wasn't with the family. It was out in front of the house. If I'm with the family in the car and I get a flat tire, it's my duty as the father and husband to change the tire while the family chills.
That's right.
Plays along the side of the road, right? Sits in the car in the air conditioning, listening to the radio, whatever. It's my duty. You know, and if some dill runs off the road and kills me, do the headlines read, father killed in the line of duty?
No.
No. That's my duty, you see.
I see.
I'm just wondering. Do all the other fathers show up with black armbands around their wedding rings or something? Not that there's anything wrong with that. I just, you know, we got a lot of problems in this town, don't we? A lot of problems with crime. I've been the victim of thievery just in my neighborhood 3 times, not to go into details. Not counting the wife's car getting stolen the one time that it got stolen. And it was recovered down in Miami and whatnot, all stripped. So we got a lot of crime going on. We see it on the news every day. And not to sound like a broken record, because we talked about this before. Now, if the guy had been doing a red light running thing, I'd be really sympathetic.
Well, it's a highway last time I checked.
Yeah, but there was no not red light. Now, I don't understand the difference, and I can't get an answer to this. If they want a sure thing, and here we're talking about, like, and we're late for the break, I'm not a macho guy, and I don't claim to be. You see these cops when you see them on the news. Did you see the high-speed, the slow-speed chase when the cops took this guy out here locally? He ran into the dealership, the car dealership. You saw it on the news.
I didn't
helicopter
see it.
Stuff,
yeah.
And all these cops, and they all look like football players, relatively speaking.
Right.
You know what I mean? They all look like really fit guys. Maybe not as big as Kimbo Camper, tall-wise, but they all seem pretty fit. And you could see that they're wearing their bulletproof vests, and they had their guns, and they had their big strapping. Obviously, they're doing some weights, arms, right? Muscular
right.
guys.
Sure.
And they ran a guy down, and they tackled him, and the one cop got a couple of punches in. Hey, I ain't complaining. That dill had it coming. Right?
Sure.
No problem there. That's what we're paying these guys to do, is to take these risks. That's why they've got the gun and the bulletproof vest that we paid for, is to do dangerous things like that. This shooting fish in a barrel speed trap business, not only is that not dangerous, but how is that protected? Oh, speed kills. Yeah. Why don't you talk to people that don't drive the roads every day? I almost got killed three times on the way to work yesterday, but it wasn't by speeders. It was by people coming into my lane. Like, right there, one of them was a truck. Here I am going next to a truck right beside it, and I'm right beside the trailer part of it. I mean, like, right in the middle of it. And the guy starts coming into my lane. Hey, off you go. I get off on the highway. I'm coming down Ivesbury Road. A cement mixer, for Christ's sakes, runs me up on the sidewalk. So, you got life and death situations every day. And this little kid that was killed at the school down there, red light runner. The news crews, like, they just discovered something new. They show up the next day, remember that? And they're recording all these people, one after another, running the red light, one after another. Gee, what a surprise. What a surprise, since nobody's writing tickets for red light runners anymore. They're all doing speed traps.
It's more money.
Why? Well, how is it more money? I guarantee you could make more money doing the red light runners. You could get 3 or 4 per light change. Talk about pulling people over en masse. People are dying there in the intersections. Kids are getting run over because nobody is stopping for a red light anymore. Nobody.
It's been that way for a while.
That way for a while. It didn't used to be that way, youngster.
Well,
in my day. Now, see here. I'll have you know, once upon a time, people stopped for that red light. 1029 on All Pissed Off Radio, 560 QAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Que se perdió la puta.
Thirty-five, 560 QAM, 351 votes on the poll on NeilRogers.com. How much do you care about the Olympics? Not at all, 133. A little, 103, somewhat, 58. What are the Olympics, 18? I only care about the Summer Olympics, 18. A lot, 11, and I hate this poll, 10. That's what I voted for. I hate this poll. I just couldn't think of anything else. It all started this morning, and I tangented away, like I always do, trying to find something to watch. There's no school today, so I allowed myself a little bit of extra sleep, and instead of catching the morning news, and that's another thing. Good luck finding something decent. Although I do appreciate that all of the stations are just putting all chick newscasters and weathercasters on this morning.
Nice.
Been getting into Channel 10 lately. I'm a big Jen Herrera fan. You go, Jen. And then I'd like to flip to Channel 4 for the, who is it, Elizabeth Hart. Now, if we could just get a dream team together where Jen does the traffic and Elizabeth Hart does the weather. All right, and then we can get Daniel Knox to read the reports. I think, we could have the Charlie's Angels right there.
Right on.
As a matter of fact, now that I think of it, we have a blonde, a Hispanic, and an African-American right there.
Did you plan that?
No, I didn't. Wow. Just fell right into that.
Nice.
They could call it the Charlie's Angels newscast because we've talked about it before. We don't really care what the people look like. If they look good, so much the better. We know they're not reading. I mean, they're reading it. They're not writing it.
Correct.
So all they got to do is be able to articulate it, pronounce the words right, or even close to right. Hell, if they look good, we don't care if they butcher it. This is true.
Now that we're thinking about it. Speaking of Africa, I've been trying to get the wife to watch Crash. I got a copy of Crash for like 2 weeks now, and it's just always one thing or another. You know, she falls asleep whenever boyfriend comes to the door, something like that. Oh, speaking of that, don't let me, because I'm tangenting.
Okay.
Again, sure way to make your wife think you're having an affair, put somebody else's hair on the bed or rouge on the bathroom sink.
Okay.
No, see, I can't do any of the stuff at home because there's always somebody at the house. So if I'm having an affair, it ain't going to be at the house. There's always a wife or
yeah.
a kid or a teenager there at the house all the time. So I have to put something on me. Maybe, like, do that. Put a hair on me. Like, get a blonde hair or something like that and hang it around my neck.
You got a black jacket there. You know, you could hang it maybe a couple
right.
over your shoulder.
Well, how about if I... No, I thought, what if I come home without my underwear? And then she's just going to think that I had an accident.
Maybe, like, you messed yourself.
And by the way, Alan, thank you so much for the fondue recipe. He sent it twice because he had a typo. If you want, I'll give you a copy of it. I don't know if you have a fondue pot or if you have any plans to get one.
But if you recommend that recipe's good,
oh,
maybe
well,
I'll get one.
We'll try it out. We'll save this. Thank you. Thank you so much, Alan. So where was I tangenting from?
With Crash. You're trying
Crash,
to get the wife.
I'm trying to get the wife to watch Crash, and I've been making Don Cheadle jokes to that effect. Because for some reason, he's on every movie now. You ever do that? You ever the cable or the TV goes through phases where on every channel there will be a movie with this one particular actor in it. And last month was Don Cheadle month. And I just like saying Don Cheadle, the fifth Beatle. Or
yeah.
You can make jokes all day long, and he was, if there was a star of Crash, someone that they spent more time with than anybody else, it would have to be him, right? Don't you think?
I don't know. I didn't see it.
The pivot man of the whole movie? Oh, you didn't see it?
No.
Really?
Really.
Oh, here, I thought you had.
I thought you said to Neil that I wouldn't like it. Was I wrong?
Did I say to Neil?
I'm pretty sure.
No, I don't think so. Oh, you would love this movie.
Okay.
There's nothing wrong with this movie at all. Good to the last drop. It's another one of those round-robin kind of anthology things, not unlike Magnolia, but unlike Magnolia, all the storylines end, and all tie in tightly, nicely. The pacing is good, and there's no frogs. See, Magnolia was good,
there's
but...
There's no frogs.
Well, it's not that I minded the frogs. Now, you saw that. The whole frog thing went on for a long time. If they had just not had frogs and ended some of the storylines, then I'd have nothing to complain about as far as Magnolia goes. Because it was a waste, because some of the performances and some of the storylines, like the Tom Cruise and his dad thing, that was so good, and that storyline ended. You know, that got resolved, right? But then some of the other ones, huh, what? What's going on here?
Yeah.
What about this? Hey, what about the guy with the braces? Is he going to get the bartender or not? He was talking to the cop, and then the gun falls out of the sky, and then what? What? Come on. Don't leave me hanging out here. But anyway, what does that have to do with Don Cheadle?
Yeah.
Hotel Rwanda. Seen it twice now. And this is a movie that's been on for, I don't know how old it is, a year, maybe two. It's about the whole chopping people with machetes thing that happened over there with the Hutus and the Tutsis. And remember,
right.
We talked about it. Mostly the conversation goes like this. What the hell's the difference between a Hutu and a Tutsi? Right? Isn't that what we're
yeah.
always saying?
That's
huh?
the question.
Hey, they all look the same to us, and they say that in the movie. As a matter of fact, one of the photographers, one of the reporters... In the beginning of the movie, is trying to get the answers to that. Like, what's this all about? So I started watching the movie because I wanted to find out what it was all about. And I didn't know Don Cheadle was in it. And he had impressed me so much in Crash that I decided to give this movie a chance because if Don Cheadle is in it, how bad can it be, right?
I think he's a good actor.
He's a great actor. As a matter of fact, in this movie, he's got the kind of African accent. I don't know what that's supposed to be. They say we have to cut the tall trees. They sound like this. I don't know. It's just genetic Haitian. You know what I'm talking about?
I know.
You have to cut the tall trees. Kill the traitors. Kill the cockroaches.
You're starting to go a little more packy now, but the first
no,
part...
No, they all sound like that. Cut the tall trees. It's time. Get your machete and cut. Cut, cut, cut. So he had that kind of an accent. He was doing a thing like that in the movie. My mistake the first time I watched it is I caught it just a little bit late, a little bit after it started. Very good movie. Like,
yeah.
Gut-wrenching, all of that. Yeah. But I missed the beginning where they explain the million-dollar question. What the hell is the difference between a Hutu and a Tutsi? So this time, it was on again over the weekend, and I caught it right from the very beginning, and now I know. I ain't going to tell you either. So now you're going to have to watch it. Maybe I should tell you.
Maybe you should.
Maybe I should, but I won't.
Okay.
Just so you know, John Cheadle.
Very Mr. Cheadle.
Yes. He's a Hutu, just so you know.
Okay.
He's the Hutu hotel manager of this hotel. That is a, and it's a true story, just so you know, we love our true stories. And it's mind-boggling stuff that happened over there that took place and just not what you think it is. I don't know what you thought it was, but it's not what you thought it was.
Okay.
All right? Whatever you thought it was, it ain't that. It's something else. And it's a little bit embarrassing because they make the point in the whole movie. And, you know, Don Cheadle keeps saying, oh, now that you've got the pictures that are showing it on the news, why is nobody coming to help us? And Nick Nolte has to explain to them, it's because you're not even an N-word. All right? You're an African black. So the people that are seeing these pictures, they're like, yeah, whatever. Isn't that how it went?
That's how it went down.
QAM, hello. Hello. Domino's Pizza. Oh, no, we got the phone thing again. Hey, happy Monday. Not to be confused with the Manchester English band, Happy Mondays, but everything is going wrong today. What else is new, right? So let's just take that break, reset the whole freaking studio, okay? And maybe when we come back, we can start a show. 17 till 11 on 560 QAM.
Big leagues, boy.
Here's the chicken, boy, thank you, hand your lips. Here's the chicken, wrap them all around the chips. Here's the chicken, get it in a grip and then you hold it. Here's the chicken, plant the bed with your strokes. Here's the chicken, until you make the chicken choke. Here's the chicken, show it that you can't see the closet. Baby, I'm blue, will make you wet. When you get it, on it or ahead. Chicken infected that way. Be afraid, be very afraid. Here's the chicken, around the neck as you pull. Here's the chicken, and hang it till your mouth is full. Here's the chicken, careful not to do it wrong and blow it.
12 to 11, 560 WQAM. Good score here, Josh. Finding the
Thank you very much.
Spike TV right now. I guess this is the Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition, the making of. Kind of a documentary.
Yes, it's fantastic
sort of thing, right?
Entertainment.
Yeah, it is. Now, the suit that they were showing before this one, apparently the one-sided suit there.
Yes.
The one-in, one-out kind of a suit, and then the model. Who is that, by the way?
I believe that's Nikki Tyler.
It does look like her. She was holding the exposed breast with her hand, all right? Now, see, these guys lack imagination right there, the guys that are standing around. If I was there, I would throw my car keys at her, right at her face. What do you think? While she's holding that thing.
Or like something, a piece of the camera. Oh, Nikki. Nikki,
yeah.
We need that.
Right. Sure.
Or, you know, what I'm thinking, though, I think maybe, you know, we shouldn't have to wonder what women's breasts look like anymore. Maybe suits should just
That's
be
right.
made that way.
Imagination.
You know, show us one
sucks.
And cover the other.
The Greeks were all about that. You know that, like, the young unmarried women, they would wear, like, the off-the-shoulder kind of thing and leave one up because that way.
I like that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not like you're hanging them out. You're just hanging one out.
Yeah.
Just for modesty's sake.
So we know what you're working.
That's all you need. We'll just presume that the other one looks just like it.
Sure.
Although that's not always the case. Ever encountered that? I have.
I've seen a couple
one-hires. Two-size difference. That's my record. A two-size difference.
Two-size?
From, right.
As in like AC?
AC. AC.
Wow.
AC-DC. Yeah.
I've never experienced anything like
that. Oh, she was real sensitive about it. I've told that story before.
Well, I would imagine.
She would, and this might sound funny, but you know how it is when you're a young, like, right around 20, maybe a little before 20, maybe like, 18, 19.
Okay.
You don't really ask a lot of questions.
No.
So she's like, we're going to have sex, but this might sound strange. She's not just going to leave her shirt on. She's going to leave her jacket on.
No
it was winter.
Way.
It was the winner. It was winner.
The Wait. Jacket?
The jacket. She wouldn't take the jacket off.
Why not like a shirt or something?
Because... Did you not hear me mention?
I did.
Two size difference.
I did, but
and so
she never wore shirts?
No, she wore shirts and everything like that, but like, well, first of all, in the Northwest, people dress in layers anyway. So she would wear,
right.
I assume, you know, like a bra with the stuffing and then a shirt and all this other stuff. She didn't even want to take her jacket off. I was like, well, it's warm in here.
It's about to get warmer.
Right, but subsequently, I mean, I pressed the issue. It's like, come on, I don't care. Like, come on, she was a teenager. Breast cancer? Do they have breast cancer in the teen years?
I've never heard of it. I'm sure it's possible.
I guess it's possible. It's like, what, an accident? I don't care. It's like, look, I don't care. You know, this was somebody that I told her I loved her or anything like that. I just told her, look, I'm really, 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 really cool. I totally won't tell this story on the radio later on in my life. I didn't say that.
What was her name?
Huh? You know, if I told you that I forgot, would that make me look like just a complete ass?
Not at all.
A total dill? I forgot. It started with an N.
Natasha.
It might have been. And I don't want to say Natasha because that's what I've been calling your girl lately, and I don't want people to think anything. All right?
No, don't worry. They're
symmetrical.
They're both healthy.
All right.
Nice and healthy.
So eventually, the second time, she exposed.
Showed you the goods.
And show enough.
Now that's
they're very curious. That's
a big difference.
Actually
right there.
Sat there, surveying them for a little while. Like, wow, that's a thing. It's a thing that happens. As a matter of fact, they've done shows about it. I don't remember who. One of those shows, like, I don't want to say Oprah, but maybe like Oprah or Murray or one of these shows, they've addressed that issue. These makeover shows, I'm not sure where I was. See, I don't know if you've gotten to the point in your relationship where you're watching a whole bunch of stuff that the girl likes, but you don't necessarily, but you don't really want to fight over it.
Well, see, I'm lucky because my girlfriend isn't the average
woman.
Obviously,
no, because I know that because she brought us stuff. She did things for us.
This is true.
So I know she's not an average woman.
Right.
There was nothing in that for her, right? For her to schlep all the way over here and bring us donuts and bagels and coffee.
No, there wasn't.
Right. She was just being nice. Wow.
I know.
Pardon me for being stunned. QAM, hello. Hello. All over the place radio. Oh, we forgot to do it.
No, I did. I reset it.
You did reset it. Well, that wasn't good enough. Do this. We'll do this on the air. As a matter of fact, do you have that filler music that I warned you about?
I do.
All right. Very good.
Your fave. You know, I figured I'd hook it up.
With a hip-hop. Now do this. It's going to sound weird. Pick up the phone. The actual unit there. Just go ahead and pick it. Don't punch it up. Just pick it up. Pick up the handle.
Well, I don't think the handle's plugged
in. All right, press the button.
Headset's in.
Press the button then. It's all right. Don't worry about it. Press the hook thing, the hanging up part. You are pressing it? I don't think so. You did press it.
I just let it go.
All right.
Here, now you try to pick one up. Try to take a call.
No, it's going there. You're not doing it right. Press the button part on the phone. Not the line button, the hanging up part button. All right, now punch a line.
While you're holding the button.
No, let go of the button. You're not doing it right.
Hey, what do you mean?
I know you don't know what I mean. I'm going to go in there and do it.
Well, come on with
it. I'm going in there.
Here he goes. He's going to do the exact same thing I just did twice, ladies and gentlemen. Go ahead. Let's go. Let's go. I'm out of his way. All right. That's exactly what I did. He even hit the same line. Same thing, man. I got the mushroom just like that.
You got mushrooms?
I got mushrooms. It's not going to work for you.
Wait a minute. You didn't do the same thing. Oh, yeah, you did.
See? What'd I tell you?
Oh, man, we're in trouble today. All right. Engineering. You know what? I don't even know why we're calling engineering.
Listen, I'm going to bet that there's no engineers here.
I know there are no engineers here. Go ahead. You can kill the music because I'm gonna start singing or something. We're going to have to do actual surgery on the phone system afterwards. First of all, I know there are no engineers here. And second of all, and I hope Joe Bell is listening, if there were some engineers here, should I even finish that sentence?
No.
They wouldn't know what to do about it. Maybe George Corso would know what to do about it, but he's a busy man. Maybe Steph would know what to do about it. You know what? But Steph would play with it. Maybe he'd fix it, but he would play with it.
No comment.
And the phone system, too. So let's just take that break. I'll play a long bit afterwards. We're going to have to take some time to do this thing over here. And besides, what's that got to do with the fact that the swimsuit, Sports Illustrated, behind the scenes.
Yeah, play a really long bit.
Yeah, is on spike right now. 4 till 11 on 560, all technical incompetence radio, WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Have you ever been?
Oh, have you ever been?
Well, needless to say, you're A-OK. You're wonderful. WQAM.
WQAM is proud to bring you the WQAM School of Broadcasting. Yes, you too can have an illustrious career in the wonderful world of radio if you follow our curriculum. The course is free. Of course, you'll work for free. Call 1-800-WANNABE and speak to our Director of Education, Mr. Lenny Martez.
So, you want me a broadcaster?
A what?
A broadcaster, a broadcaster.
Broadcaster.
Well, can you say news?
News.
No, it's not news, it's news.
News.
I'll take you on a tour, you need help. Here, we have the Joe Rose Beginner's Course.
Repeat it after me, man.
We have the effective delivery rule.
We know what you need. We need it. Please give us a call. All you gotta do is call us right now. Repeat after me.
Open your books to page 14. Repeat after me. And, no, that's what I want you to repeat. Go ahead.
Okay.
And opening this room is Jody 101.
Yes, it's the wonderful world of radio. Radio, where you can hear your own voice. Let the WQAM School of Broadcasting provide you with the essential tools you'll need to make your wet radio dreams come true. I mean, one come true.
Going in my truck, there's a chicken all ready for the sacrifice there, really. Yeah, well, Timmy's here, if nothing else. Hey, you know, Timmy, go nuts. We'll do this all on the air. We just tried every funky witch reset configuration way that we know how to do it. And there you go. What the hell's that on your head? Did you always have that? You always have that dot? Really? You just never noticed it because your hair was covering it before? I'm not going to insult you. I mean, that's the last thing I want to do is insult Timmy, especially when he's trying to fix our stuff. Especially now that he's got that big tattoo on his arm. If you thought he was intimidating before, just check that out. Anyway, yeah, we can't punch a call up and get it on the air, Timmy. That's how it's going. Go ahead here. Like, we'll try it on the hotline.
Oh, wow. Oh, pain, the old double piercy post thing there. Ow.
He's got the earring thing, but it's not pierced.
Oh, I just
like,
saw that.
It's not, he didn't pierce the lobe part, man. He pierced the cartilage part right there on the inside. That's exciting.
That just looks painful.
We'll play with it a little more later once we get this phone situation fixed. This is what happens, man. I punch it up and it goes to speakerphone over there, and the thing that we normally do to get it working again, that ain't working. And I know it's Monday. We probably got hit by lightning. Probably people were all in these studios going through my personal belongings and doing their personal demo tapes to get a job on another radio station all weekend long. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but just put things back down. No, forget it. You know, I was just absentmindedly going to go try to punch up a call, but that's not going to work. So, hey, for the people that are calling, just keep calling, I guess. You might be the lucky one. Wow. And it doesn't even sound right.
Well, wait, try it now.
Try it now? Yeah, I'm getting the speakerphone thing indicating to me that I'm activating the line over there. I'm not getting the arrow. I'm not getting the green arrow or the green hornet or the green lantern.
I got
right? Or the green weenie. So we've already reset both units twice. I just reset the computer. I changed configuration. We reset the system in there, and I tried it with both of these phones. I already tried this business, Timmy. The audience is just loving this, I can tell. I can just feel the knobs turning.
Now, this is radio magic right here.
Right, yeah. We're in mode. We're in studios. Hybrid 1, desktop director. I tried desktop director 1 and 2, and there's no difference. Watch this. I get that, but that doesn't do anything. Is that making a sound? Am I punching anything up there?
Static, man.
That's
it's the
doing
mushroom.
Nothing. Right. Actually, what you're calling the mushroom is a symbol of a phone.
Is that right?
You get it?
I get it.
I know it's a little basic, but that's supposed to look like a phone. Not that I know where your head's at. You see anything, you know, round on top, you think it's a mushroom, but that's okay. At least you think it's a mushroom. Not
what would Neil think it is?
Huh?
What would Neil think it is?
432 votes on the poll right now. How much do you care about the Olympics? Not at all. 162, a little. 119, somewhat. 77. I only care about the Summer Olympics. 24. What are the Olympics? 22. A lot. 15. And I hate this poll. 13. I guess Josh would care more about the Olympics if it was done in the old Grecian style. In other words, everybody naked.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know that the this is a Paul Harvey rest of the story kind of thing. You know the coaches had to be naked too, right?
They had to be?
Yeah. That's because, well, one of the Olympians, as a matter of fact, Discovery Channel did a whole big thing on how they would do things back then in ancient Greece. And the Olympics, too.
Mm-hmm.
And they were pretty brutal. Like, the boxing event that they had, they would wrap their fists up with these real stiff chunks of leather that would take chunks out of your face when they hit you. And that was all good for them. But apparently there was this contestant that did really well and won, and his mother was his coach. And it was when it was found out that a woman, because you know how the Greeks felt about that a woman was involved in their fun, they got all wiggy and said, all right, from now on, anybody down there on the field is going to be running around with it out, with their dill out. All right? And so no confusion here. We don't want any women infesting our good male macho time over here. Now, the women, just so you know, they had their own parallel event nearby off to the side. Like, not where the regular arena was, like just sort of in a field somewhere nearby.
Right.
They had the chick games.
Now, did they have them out?
I don't know. That's the million-dollar question, and I was thinking that too. But even if they didn't, is there any doubt which event I would be at and
no.
I would be watching? And you go, oh, but George, you don't like watching sports. No, but I like watching women running. Or sitting. Can you imagine? I mean, they did all the very similar things, too. They did races. They did wrestling.
Wrestling. Women's wrestling.
Yes.
What's not to like?
Greek women's wrestling. Now, in all likelihood, they probably were not wearing their full tunics while they were doing that.
It's okay.
So, yeah. Yeah. Not to mention that the Greeks, they just hung it out all the time anyway. The chicks, that is. Well, I guess the guys, too. When you get right down to it. It sounds like we're just prattling on waiting for Timmy to fix the phone system. Guess what? We're just prattling on waiting for Timmy to fix the phone system. If you have a fax, that's the best we can do. 305-650-0198.
Here's a fax. Hello.
Speaking of that, I know I did get a fax. Thank you, Mark. Mark with a B. I was going to talk about this earlier because I subscribed to Celebrity Death Beeper.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Al Neary died. A debonair 68-year-old actor, half a century, the Godfather actor, Richard Bright, whose piercing blue eyes and dark hair saw him often cast as a cop or a criminal, crumpled to the ground as he was hit by the rear wheel of an Academy bus around 6:30 p.m. as it turned left on Columbus Avenue, 86th Street in New York. I'm trying to put together, and if somebody knows, call in. Wait, you can't. Because it says he's a veteran of the Godfather movies, of course, Al Neary, we know who that is. And I'm looking through here because the report that I read earlier said that he was also an actor on The Sopranos, and I'm trying to figure out which one. And I'm reading through the story, and I can't find it. Of course, I'm not going to read the whole story on the air.
I mean, I could probably find it online.
Yeah, we'll find out later. You know what's better, though, is people calling and having a conversation since it's a talk show. That's what's better instead of just us talking because, you know, we do that all the time. Ain't nothing new about that. Speaking of faxes,
go ahead and give it a shot.
I'm going to punch something up. Hey. All right, is it going to sound like that on the air? No, let's hear that dial tone on the air, though. Is that right? Well, here, let's spearmint. QAM.
George.
Hey.
You got it fixed.
Woo! Timmy got it fixed, sir. He's not just a strong man, he's also strong.
He's the man.
He is the man.
Yeah, it was ringing and ringing and ringing. And
that's right. Thank you, Timmy. We love you. Check's in the mail.
Listen, I just want to agree with you on this cops getting hit on the side of the road and all this turmoil. I wasn't
done with that, but go ahead. Let's hear your piece.
We're getting hit on the side of the road. They're coming up in bus stops and taking us out. They're coming on the sidewalk,
yeah,
running through buildings. Where's the memorial service for one of us?
We've talked about that, and it's not like, look, I don't, you know, we don't want to piss the cops off because you know what happens when you do, right? They'll beat you with a billy bat.
Yeah, well, down here they just shot a guy. He threw rocks at him. So they shoot him in the back as he's running away. He's throwing rocks.
Well, he shouldn't do that.
Well,
he won't do it again.
And as far as the guy, they chased
him. Learn him.
He ran out of his car, supposedly robbed a bank, and they're chasing him out of his car. The guy's turned around. He put his hands way out to his side.
And they tackle him and they punch him anyway because they got to get their licks in while they got you.
As far as I'm concerned, the cops are just another gang. You know, you got your Crips, your Bloods, your Mafia, your Hell's Angels, your cops.
All right.
You see any of them coming, get out of the way. That's
all. I'm not going to agree with that, but I feel your pain.
No, come on.
All right.
Because
the cops are humans. That means there are good cops and there are bad cops.
Yeah,
and what offends me is when they all stick together. See, if the good cops would stand up and point out the bad ones and say, hey, you're making the rest of us look bad instead of covering up for them, then I'd be more sympathetic to the lot of them. You know what I mean?
That's exactly what
I thought. Everybody bands together like you were just saying, like the lawyers band together and the doctors band together, and everybody's like this fraternity where it's us against the world. How about you're supposed to be on our side, American people, tax-paying people?
Exactly. Us.
U.S. Us.
We the people.
That's right.
Well, you know,
because I've known some very, very good cops, and you see them every day. People that hang it out there, hang their lives out there. People that go out of their way to be good. I know people that are cops that feel like they're swimming upstream against the system, the way that it is, and doing their best to do a good job. And I'm not going to slight them by lumping them all into one category.
Yeah, but they're the ones who sit there and look in the eye and say, "Yeah, I know
maybe
there's bad cops." But hey, that means all cops are bad because who's going to arrest the bad cops?
Well, I'm
not going to arrest them. You.
No, Forrest Whitaker. Forrest Whitaker's going to arrest him.
Oh, man.
Good luck to us. And by the way, I didn't know this. Did you, Josh? Because they were talking on the news, and one of the news stories that I saw was talking about how, according to the law that started sometime, I don't know when, but nobody told me that it did, when a cop has got somebody pulled over on the side of the road, you're supposed to either change lanes.
That's not a law.
That's what they were saying.
Then they're just making it up as they go.
How do you know, Mr. Lawyer?
I've never heard of it either.
But that doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. You're supposed to change lanes out of the lane that is next to where the cops are. Let's say that the cop has somebody pulled over.
What did you just hear this?
The left
guy
side.
Died.
It was on the news story. The guy died, and they were doing a news story, and they were showing a cop pulling people over, and people flying by at whatever, you know, 100 miles an hour in the lane right next to where the cop had the guy pulled over. And what the cop was saying, and argue with that guy, if you will, is that you're either supposed to change lanes out of that lane or slow down. Are you ready for this? Slow down to, you ready?
I'm ready.
20 miles an hour.
Right.
Now, I'm on the left side of the highway in the fastest lane, let's just call it. Let's not call it the speed lane. Let's just call it the faster lane, the carpool lane, the leftmost lane. Right?
Right.
What's going to happen to you if you slow down to 50? Miles an hour.
Either that or, you know.
You mean you run into those people all the time, and that's a pun. You run into those people every day. People going slow in the left lane. We curse them. We curse them and their parents and anybody that looks like them. Every day.
True.
They honestly expect us to do that. So the bottom line of this whole thing is the people who we pay to make our lives easier and safe, because whatever they might think their job description is, that's what it is. I, your boss, have said so. You're supposed to be there to protect and serve and make our life easier, not more difficult. So here you are, and by the way, when a cop has somebody pulled over, you know that slows everybody down on both sides, right?
Because they stop, they slow down.
Everybody
anyway.
Slowing down. Oh, they see the bubblegum machine up ahead, they slow down, they freak out, they panic, so everybody's slowing down anyway. So now the cop, engaged in his ticket-writing activity and his shooting fish in a barrel activity, is slowing the flow of traffic, the opposite of what he's supposed to be there for. And now they expect us to slow down even more? Or to just eliminate that lane altogether?
That's right.
I don't think I agree with that. I don't know about you.
I definitely don't.
All right, but I disrespectfully disagree. 11:14 on 560 QAM.
Wait, hold on a second.
Oh, wait, I know. You're a little bit distracted.
Timmy got
here.
Me all, you know.
Got you
lost.
All worked up with his muscles and his tattoo and that brand new piercing that he's got. And how about that haircut, speaking of mushrooms, now that he's out of the room?
How about that mole?
Turn the TV on. That's right, honey. This is my favorite part of the Winter Olympics, too.
Sure I didn't play this already?
Yeah, let's sit good and close so we can watch that young gal skate backwards.
Yeah.
Oh, she's putting her skates on. Here she comes. Here she comes. Single, double, triple, triple butts. There's no way to overrate women when they figure skate. Skin tight out. To those shapely bobs. That is when my girlfriend snaps me out of my chair. Come on, babe, it ain't my fault. It's so hard not to stare at the figure skate. But don't. Doing splits and spinning with next to nothing on. It might be wrong watching all night long. And who eats is and that ice is gonna fall. I sit there and gone. Yeah, I'm completely gone. Lord have mercy, how she keep her leg up there so long? It's that figure skate, but don't. Yeah, son, that's what I'm talking about.
1120-560 WQAM 5670560 is the number in Dayton Broward. Pound 560 is free if you have Singular or Verizon wireless service. As 877-785-6345 is toll free everywhere. Is this going to be an all day event on Spike TV?
I sure hope so.
Yeah, me too. Because so far so good. And I see they didn't start out with the thongs and the see through tops, but they wound up there eventually.
Yes, they did.
So this is a very good show. So we don't care if nothing works on this particular Monday. And I guess it's because of holiday. It's a holiday. That's why they're showing this.
Yeah, that's
fine.
What it is.
And I don't even mind getting the screwed out of the day off that I was supposed to get. You know what? I called in sick because I've just been terminally ill lately. But, you know, for any number of reasons, Timmy came in here and coughed on me. He has the flu.
Oh, God.
I'll probably catch that. I've just been catching everything. Just my immune system is going south. As I get older, my hair and my immune system. QAM, hello. Hello. Forgot to get that schedule, too. I want to promote our lineup today, but I have no idea what it is. QAM, hello.
Hello, George.
Hey.
Couple of things. The Al Neary actor on The Sopranos.
Yes.
The only thing I can remember him in is when they were about to whack Johnny Stack.
Yeah.
And, Uncle Junior said, go up and see Lou DiMaggio and Silvio. And up there were Christopher to, I think it was Christopher, to these crazy blind people, kind of mongoloid-looking people up in
Yeah. Oh, yeah. These old, like the old hitmen.
Yeah, exactly.
They were using walkers and wheelchairs.
Right. Everybody's like, well, having cake, Pavel, would you like to stay? And he was, I guess he was the guy, Lou Maggio, or one of the guys who was supposed to whack Johnny Sacks.
Now I remember.
It was on like 2 nights ago, which is the only reason I remember it.
Those were when the episodes were still good.
Yeah, exactly.
And all of a sudden it's coming back in March? I thought they were done. I thought they just got so embarrassed that they stopped making them.
No, March 12th, and then I guess 12 episodes this year, and possibly 8 more next year, I think. Either way, they've got 20 episodes. So
now,
I mean,
normally, that would get me all excited right away, but yeah. I'm out. I'm waiting.
They got to earn their stripes again. But hey,
yeah.
Going back to what you were just talking about, just to clarify something about the law, the move over law.
Yeah, I would like to know, because I always curse the people that would slow down, and mind you, you know, it's not like... It's not like we want there to be unsafe conditions out there, but I mean, come on, you're not supposed to change lanes when somebody's fixing their tire and their ass is hanging out of the, you know, on the other side of the line there.
Well, what it said was it's called like supposedly the move over law. You don't have to slow down to 20 miles an hour. You have to reduce your speed limit by 20 miles per hour.
Oh, so if you're going 100, Got to slow down to 80.
Go down to 80. Or, okay. They said, or like, as you said, or move over. It's only if you see a cop car or an emergency vehicle. If you see some schlepper on the side of the road.
No, see, generally speaking, I move over anyway, whether it's a cop or somebody changing their tire, just because. You know what I mean? Because why take the risk, you know, give them a nice wide margin?
Yeah, you're driving along, you sneeze or something, you turn the wheel the wrong way, and next thing you're in the middle.
You see those videos, because, I mean, speaking of Spike TV, they love the cop videos on this channel over here. And and you see these videos over and over and over again of the cop giving somebody a ticket, and here comes this dill out of nowhere crashing into the car that the cop is standing behind.
You know, and that's true. I've seen a million of those as well.
Sure.
And Channel 7 was at its very worst the other night with this. I mean, the kid who hit the guy, he was just, I guess,
he was a punk with a suspended license, didn't deserve to be on the road. I hope they give him the electric chair.
Right. And they were reporters in front of the kid's house. And
the village people should be out in front of his house. I'm not talking about the musical act. I'm talking about the ones that chased Frankenstein up to the tower. They should be out there with torches and pitchforks.
Or the Lou Maggio family in The Sopranos. That would get it done.
Hey.
So, George, what are you here all week?
Yes, I'm here all week. Thank you very much. Neil's back next Monday.
Thanks a lot.
All right, thank you. QAM, hello.
You love the Greek, huh?
QAM, hello.
Hey, George.
Hey.
I've got a question for you. What's so bad about Norton's antivirus? Because I got it on my computer, and I heard you tell me
I just had a weekend-long conversation about Norton. I don't know what's good about it. I personally, at my house, I own two computers, and then every family member also owns a computer of their own, and none of us use Norton. I uninstalled Norton and Symantec from all of the computers. We only surf with Firefox. Everyone in my family, anyway, knows not to click on any kind of a pop-up or any ad whatsoever, nor to open any attachment that doesn't come from anyone that they personally know. It's kind of like the same policy as like when you get drugs. You know, you just don't go buying ecstasy or anything from people that you don't know. You want to make sure that that the people that you're getting it from have already tried it and it's got their seal of approval. So other than the little that it costs you money, it slows your system down and that little thing keeps popping up. I don't know, but people are probably going to call up and say, you're crazy. You're giving people bad advice. You're going to have people's computers infected. The story is because I argue with one of my friends, Dudley, who won't listen to me, and he uses AOL, and his computer is always infested like a dirty hooker. He would argue his computer is always having problems, and I said, I could help you, but you don't want to listen to me because you browse with AOL, and he doesn't want to listen to me. So one time I show up and he's got the box of Norton the size of the giant laundry detergent box. Norton plus everything
the
else.
Utilities, yeah.
Yeah, and he's doing a system scan, and I get there just in time to see file number 587 found of either virus or spyware or something like that. And I'm going, man, I told you your filthy machine was infested from using that AOL. All right, Mr. Smarty Pants, let me scan your computer with it. And I let him, and for 2 years I haven't had Norton on my computer and only been using Firefox. He found one piece of spyware on there. One.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, because I had Norton tell me something once with a worm or something on Yahoo, because that's what I log in through.
Mm-hmm.
I use cable modem. So I don't know if Norton's actually helping.
Well, see, the thing about Yahoo, I use Yahoo Mail for everything questionable.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? They have Norton. They run everything through a Norton filter already before you even get it. So.
No, but this is one day I just logged on, and as soon as I logged on, I got a worm.
You're also probably surfing with Internet Explorer, are you not?
No. I use Firefox.
Okay.
I don't touch that stuff.
Well, then I don't.
I uninstalled on Internet Explorer. For my
I haven't used Norton in years.
Okay.
All right. Well, and I know people are going to call up saying that I'm full of crap, but sorry.
The hell with them. The
exactly.
Them. Remember, all for me. Bye.
All right. Oh, ho, ho.
All for me.
Seriously, of all the things that
now
we've ever come across.
TV.
Yeah, oh boy, it's hot. You can just chomp.
Which I was going to tell you, the guy who called about The Sopranos.
Yes.
They have to, they have to really impress us this season. But they're starting with, Fergie's going to be a stripper.
Hey now, at the bada bing?
Yeah, at the bada bing.
Now, what do you think the odds are that she's actually going to show her stuff?
Oh, I say no chance, but
boy can dream, though.
Yeah.
Look, I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt, because once upon a time, there was nothing better on TV. Right? Once upon a time. They were it.
Well, what else are you going to watch on Sunday?
Nothing until Rome starts back up.
Yeah, hurry.
Oh, please. And then I don't know what happened. They had the writer's strike. I've heard all these stories about why it happened, the writer's strike. This person went away. They let this person handle it, and it got, like, bad. It went from the best thing on TV to the worst.
It was terrible. It was
horrible.
The last two seasons have been marginal.
Embarrassing. The last two seasons were marginal. There were maybe two episodes per season the past two or three seasons that were even worth watching.
But if you summarize a season, nothing happens.
Right, nothing happens. They just spun their wheels.
Yeah.
What happened with the freaking Russian in the woods? You know, that episode gave us some hope, and then they just dropped it. That guy ran out there.
When what's his name is in the truck, you know.
Right.
Doing the deed, so to speak.
Uh-huh.
Nothing. There was not another word about that.
It's just like sloppy. It's like a whole bunch of people were involved, and they weren't talking to each other. Benefit of the doubt, and you're right. What the hell else are you going to watch on Sunday night? 1129, 560 WQAM. Oh, I'm sorry. I was reading this story about Pharrell. You want to hear it?
Yeah, I do.
Maybe later.
Hi, boys and girls. It's me, Mecha Mouse, from Disney's latest theme park in beautiful Damascus, Syria. It's a small mind after all. Now, we pass up taking the kids to Disney Damascus, you know, because they blow up so fast. Come see Space Mountain Cave Hideout, Mr. Bin Laden's Wild Ride, Scud's Lightyear Space Ranger Spin, Insurgents of the Caribbean, and especially Indiana Jones and the Temple of Boom. And by the way, sure, please stone that tramp Cinderella to death for not wearing a burka, but what the hell's the matter with you people? I don't know what you've been smoking, but ever since Goofy blew himself up, Eldon Ald and I I've been trying to spread the word that cartoons are about as real as Walt's last acid-induced Technicolor dream, people. So, come visit us at Disney World Damascus, where Donald Duck doesn't wear pants, but our women are covered, and where Tomorrowland is set in 1352. And for all you infidels, M-I-C, see you soon. K-E-Y.
Why?
Because we hate you. M-O-U-S.
1134, 560 QAM, you know, they had the guy, the one Molof, the Danish guy that started this whole cartoon flap. He was offended by the cartoons. He was on 60 Minutes last night. And for those of you who don't know how it went down here, I'll sum it up real quickly.
I watched 60 Minutes last night.
Did you?
Not that part.
So, yeah, did you watch the Philip Seymour Hoffman part? Because that's where I changed it. It's like, I like him, he's good, but I just
turned it on and I was... I
hate it when they do these human interests, let's kiss some celebrity's ass, let's get into some celebrity. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that's not why I watch 60 Minutes. I watch 60 Minutes because they're at least traditionally...
And the global warming.
Yeah, well, that doesn't exist. The global warming that doesn't exist. I'm feeling really uncomfortable living here at sea level. I don't know about you.
Yeah, I'm not too happy.
I mean, heading for the hills, you know, I got the house up there. I mean, mind you, it's very bare bones. Not that we don't have our satellite dish. Of course we do. Indoor plumbing. Oh, somebody left the electricity on up there. I've been heating that house, the empty house. I don't want to tell you what
nobody in it.
I had to call Buster. Buster built the house. Buster wasn't there to talk to his wife, Mildred. Said, think I can get Buster to go up there and see if the heat's on? Maybe you could turn it off. I'm paying to heat the house, and there ain't nobody there. She goes, well, he's working now. I'll tell him when he gets in. Bless you. Woo! Yeah. What's going on there? By the way, you have the audio, the monitor's working back in there? Everything's working here today?
Oh, yeah, I think we're good to go.
All right. Very good. Very, very good. So the cartoon controversy went down like this. They printed these. By the way, that same newspaper, I know it was mentioned, I think, even on the show, they refused to print some cartoons because they said, we stand for freedom of speech, and we don't care who it is, and we print cartoons about Jesus. Aha, they lied. Apparently, a cartoonist did make some cartoons involving Jesus, and the newspaper refused to run them, saying, we're afraid that there might be a hue and cry. There might be an outcry. We might outrage or offend some people, and we don't want to go there. But Muhammad, that's okay. Which, by the way, that is okay, as far as I'm concerned.
But what happened to the Jesus stuff?
Well,
I want to see it.
They're a bunch of hypocrites. Apparently, there are more Christians in Denmark than there are Muslims. It's only 2% Muslims.
Oh,
so,
Jesus.
So they're exactly.
Jesus Christ.
So they're worried. Oh, the booby painting. Here we go, booby painting. We don't have time for the show today. They're painting women's breasts. On Spike, right now. Lordy. So anyway, the newspaper's a bunch of hypocrites. But nevertheless, just because they believe that Muhammad should not be portrayed, that doesn't mean that I have to agree with that. And if you believe that that gives you the right to, you know, kill me or attack me or something like that, then it's on, right?
Yeah.
Because we're not going to agree about that. And you know I've always stood up for them, right? Even when nobody else would, the raw deal that the Palestinians are getting and all that, try to be neutral, try to be objective, try to consider both sides of the issue, whatever that issue is, because that's the only way that you're going to resolve an issue. Right? Even Jesus said, put the other guy's shoes on, something like that. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you and everything. And it's a good plan. Before you get all pissed off at somebody, maybe try to look at the situation from their perspective to see if they've got a reason to be pissed off in the first place. And in this case, no, they don't. And this guy, they show a clip of one of his sermons, and he's a fire and brimstone mulla mulla. He's up there preaching just like the Southern Baptists, you know, banging on the podium and pointing with his finger like Howard David. Now, see here! I'll have you know, and he says, oh, I'll have you know, this show is very distracting. Now see here, and we are, I can see there. Now, why can they show a painted breast? Why can they show a see-through top? You know what I mean? But not the actual uncovered breast.
Well, a lot of people would be offended if that happened.
Yeah, oh, especially, who would be offended more? Who's offended more? The Christians or the Muslims? So he's back to his speech. He's up there at his podium, at the pulpit, whatever the hell the Muslims call their pulpit, their bully pulpit. And he says something that I had heard before, so I guess this is exactly what they think. Muhammad was the perfect man. Did you know that?
Now I do.
This confirms something that I had heard earlier. This is one of the reasons that they're, or if not the reason that they're so upset, is because as the perfect man, any portrayal of him, any, obviously there are no photographs around 600 AD or whenever the hell that was. I think it was 600 AD. There are no photographs. So any artist's depiction of Muhammad would be less than perfect. And since he was perfect, any depiction is an insult. You understand?
Of course.
Because it would be a caricature, a less than perfect representation of a perfect man. Well, let me just say this. Because they say the same thing about Jesus. He was the perfect man, God, and all this stuff.
Wasn't he, though?
All of you get bent, all right? All of you take a flying leap. Believe what you want to believe. If you believe that it is your responsibility to force your crap on other people, then we're going to have an issue, and there is no resolution. The resolution is get yourself to your church, synagogue, temple, tent, cave, open field, wherever it is that you practice your hokum. Gather yourself together with the other hokum practitioners and have a gay old time wrestling snakes, praying on the carpet, doing the whatever it is that you believe gets you to heaven. All right? And leave me out of it, and understand this, that I reserve the right to make fun of your silly asses, whatever silly crap you believe in, whatever religious nonsense you believe in, whatever the name of God you call God by, whatever it is, that's a source of humor for me. All right? And if we have to have a war, then we'll have a war. All right? Because I'm not changing. And all these people going, and I heard this guy, that was right after it happened on NPR, this guy was saying, you know, I'm Dutch, and I think this is embarrassing, but you have to respect other people's religious beliefs. No, you don't. No, you don't have to respect other people's religious beliefs. All right? I do not. And I have no intention. All right? Your religious beliefs are funny at best. All right? Funny at best. Not that I want to take the particular issue with Islam, because it's Christianity that's messing with our lives over here, for the most part. All right?
I mean, I don't see any other religions.
That's the one over here.
The fanatical.
The reason that we can't
things.
See the nipples that we were talking about on TV is because of the freaking Christians, all right? They're the ones that feel that it's their right to deny us the things that we want. And I know why, by the way. It's because you're all miserable and you want people to be miserable just like you. If you were happy, you'd be busy doing whatever it is that makes you happy. And you wouldn't have time messing with the rest of us. But that's all you do, is mess with the rest of us. All right? So your religion is not just humor for me, but it's also offensive to me. The message of Christianity is offensive to me. when people say, you are worthless without what I have to offer you, when the clergyman says, you're worthless, you're going to hell, you're damned at birth unless you do these prescribed things that I am prescribing to you, that's an insult, and it's offensive, all right? So you're not just a source of ridicule, but you're a source of grief, all right? QAM, hello. Hello.
George.
Yes.
Hey, how you doing? Good
all right.
Job.
Listen,
just one thing. Why don't the cops go to the passenger side of the car instead of making new laws? It seems they could watch traffic and the driver.
As a matter of fact, if the passenger seat is empty, why don't the cop just crawl in the car with the guy?
There you go.
And then they'll both be safe on there, and there's air conditioning usually.
That's right.
You know, they can chill. The cop, instead of telling the guy, hey, turn your radio down, you know, and we're being smartasses here, of course, but there's a whole bunch of ways that they could do things. But understand something, sir. It's not their job to accommodate us, their employer. It's our job to accommodate
there
them, the employee.
That's right.
All right?
That's right.
As long as you got that straight, we'll all get along just fine, and you won't get beat. 1142 on All Cop Radio, 560 WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Anybody here seen Jack Abramon in his orange jumpsuit and fedora? He screwed a lot of people, but thieves sometimes get caught. I caught in Variety, the O'Connor. Anybody here seen good Christian doctrine? He'll be more around her time. He's not convicted yet, but should be before he's done, taking a shower with his son. Favors and lies is what the White House is paid for. Moralist Christians who know what's best for you and me. Abram on that day, he was in some deep. In other words, do anybody here please say to Tom Delaney, Cornish Elton, Cox Ahoy. This kind of slide belong in Camp KY. Abram of Dobson and Tom.
Well, I did find her husband's name. We're talking about Tani Katane now because apparently she's on this. We don't have this issue. How come? This is a sports station. Normally, these issues are making their rounds every time they come out. The Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue is what I'm talking about. And if you're not on Spike TV right now, then you must be gay or at work or something. Well, we're managing both.
Of course,
we are. We do have that privilege. By the way, when you start your list of things that you would like to change in the studio, now that there's a chance that we might actually be able to upgrade these facilities to where they should be, why don't you put a TV with audio?
I'll email Joe Bell right now.
Yeah, on the list, because they just showed, and I guess this is fresh. This is like this last issue here. Compliments on Tani Katane. She's got to be 40-something now, right, at the very least? And
yeah.
That was a high, hard ass
that
they were showing a lot of there on that. Now, let me ask you, I don't know what the name of the movie is. There's one of these Boy in a Plastic Bubble movies.
Bubble Boy.
Bubble Boy.
With,
Not the Bubble Boy that you're thinking of.
Oh, no, then.
Not the most recent Bubble Boy with Jake Gyllenhaal.
That's what I thought.
No.
There was
another Bubble Boy movie where she's full frontal.
Okay, why haven't I seen this Bubble Boy movie?
Because you're young, you're sheltered, And that's why you hang out with people that know these things. We'll steer you in the right direction. I got to get a copy of that movie. I saw it on cable like 100 years ago. Yeah, she's like in a shower or something like that, and she goes crashing through the glass. There's blood involved, but it's okay. We know it's fake blood. It was real blood when she kicked the crap out of her husband. I just looked it up. Finley? I don't know who that is. Let me go back to the page, and I'll tell you exactly who it is, because you expect me to remember this. Cleveland Indians pitching star Chuck Finley.
Oh.
Do you know now?
I don't.
Did you know that he is 6'6"?
Now I do.
Did you know that she was wearing high-heeled pumps, and she swiveled in her seat in the car, and while he was driving, kicked the crap out of him, puncturing his arm, thigh, and where else? Gouging him in the thigh, leg, and arm as he drove.
Wow.
All right. Now, here's the million-dollar question. If you knew that you were going to get there with her, on the way to there, if you knew, if somebody said, Josh, I got a date, a sure thing date lined up for you and Tawny Katane, whose real name is Julie. Did I mention that?
No, you didn't.
Whose real name is Julie. But on the way to the date, she's going to take giant gouges out of you with her high-heeled pumps while you're driving.
I suck it up.
All you got to do is get there safely.
I suck it up.
Yeah, yeah. Right. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't even have to treat me till afterwards.
I take those puncture wounds as long as I can make a couple.
That's right.
A puncture wound later myself.
What are you getting at, Mr. Graphic? So, I don't know how old she is. We can look that up. But she's in fine shape. And I you know what? I woke up today. I totally wasn't expecting to see Tawny Katane's ass. And
you know, Nikki Taylor's got to be in like the 35 range-ish.
God bless her.
Also.
She's fine.
Yes, she is.
Yes, she is. And we're all distracted. But what's that got to do with Outlaw Josie Wales is better than Tombstone? No, I just throw that in there and razz you.
Oh,
one
no.
of these days. We are going to have that out one of these days. As a matter of fact, I say gunfight. What do
okay.
you think? Paintball, gunfight. We'll get our holsters, and we'll do an okay corral kind of scenario.
I'm okay with that.
Somebody, you know, somebody can blow a whistle.
I say you start on one side of the woods, I'm on
That's
the
right.
other. And we just...
And we'll duke it out. And the winner gets to proclaim that their cowboy movie is better than the other guy's cowboy movie.
I think, I shoot you until you scream Tombstone.
Now, we argue about this off the air. Tombstone, let's see, when I hear Tombstone, I'm thinking pizza.
All for me!
And I saw Tombstone twice, just to be fair. We argue this off the air all the time, because neither one of us really like cowboy movies.
Right, I'm not a, yeah, it's not my genre.
But we make exceptions when they happen to be good movies in their own right, and that's the way I feel about Outlaw Josie Wales. It's in my, I don't know, top 20, if I had a top 20.
It's a great movie.
Funny.
Holding that number 2 slot in my westerns.
I don't see, and I'm watching Tombstone, and nothing wrong with it. Great, but it doesn't have anywhere near the comedy that Outlaw does. And Outlaw doesn't skimp on the violence either, as you know. Great
yeah.
monologues.
Yeah.
Great dialogue.
The comedy comes from Doc Holliday in Tombstone.
Yes.
Val Kilmer
right.
is the comedy.
He's funny.
Is your source of comedy. The characters are portrayed the best in that movie, in my
mm-hmm.
opinion.
But, I mean, come on.
Hey,
you're
listen.
Are you just going to whistle Dixie? How many lines? If you just based on the one-liners, you know, I got to make a living. I ain't much of a living, boy. Just
yeah.
so many good lines.
Look, I'm with you.
All right. It's better. All right. We won't fight over it. I think that, now, you saw Tombstone first, right?
No.
No? Really?
No.
Okay. Because isn't Outlaw Josie Wales older than you?
Yes.
Okay.
It's got to be.
557 votes on the poll right now on neilrogers.com. How much do you care about the Olympics? Not at all. 208. A little. 147. Somewhat. 98. I only care about the Summer Olympics. 30. What are the Olympics? 27. A lot. 27. I hate this poll. 21. And we still have no ideas for tomorrow's poll or the rest of it. How about this? We can do a poll.
What's the best TV networks? Spike
yeah,
TV's
Spike TV
vote.
Right now. We can do a poll. What do you think about Tawny Katane's ass?
Yeah.
It's great. We'll just have one option on there. QAM, hello. Look at that. QAM, hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Is this
Yes.
AM
yes, it is. This is
yeah.
AM 560 WQAM, your choice for sports.
Sports.
And fun.
Excellent. You guys still talking about movies?
We're talking about whatever you want to talk about, sir. It's your show.
Oh, it's my
it's
show.
It's your
huh?
show. It's about what you want it to be about.
Well, I was talking about Westerns a little bit ago.
We were just now. Outlaw Josie Wales is so much better than Tombstone, I don't even know where to start.
Well, you know, there's a couple of great westerns, though, you didn't throw out there. You got Unforgiven, of course.
It's fine. It's okay.
I just thought that scene at the end where Clint's walking through town.
It's a good movie. It's a good movie, but it ain't no Outlaw Josie Wales.
How about Silverado?
Silverado was funny and fun. Did you see Silverado, Josh?
I don't think I did.
Silverado was a fun, fun time western, you bet.
Yeah, I had a great time watching Silverado. One of
that
the
was way better because when I start watching a western, I don't expect to like it at all. All right.
Well, yeah,
and Silverado
exactly.
was just, talk about fast, fun, like kind of corny in spots, but in a good way.
Well, I mean, throughout your cast there, you had old Kevin Costner, Jeff Goldblum, Danny Glover. Oh, was that guy from Kung Fu who was in there? Kevin Kline was in
was
that.
Great.
Brian Dennehy, Jeff Fahey.
Sure.
Oh, my God.
As a matter of fact, it was very throwbacky because you know how, like, the old-timey westerns are so fake? The guys, you know, they shoot all day. They never have to reload. It was that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they definitely played into that genre, but they had a lot of fun with it, though. I mean, it was a good movie.
Nothing wrong with Silverado at all.
And my personal favorite, though, would be Once Upon a Time in the West.
Oh.
Well,
it was long.
It was so stylized.
It was ponderous.
I mean,
same thing with The Good,
Sergio
the Bad, and the Ugly.
Film.
I watched that again the other day just because I liked the music so much, and I'd forgotten what a ponderous, long, droll piece of crap that thing is.
Well, you know, you smoke a few bowls, it'll help you get through it a little quicker,
I smoked more than a few, and it didn't help, trust me.
But, I
Wallach,
talked about
God,
movies, and
God
I had to call
bad.
In, and,
Dundee! Sorry.
But, yeah, you guys have a good day. I need to get back to work.
All right.
Have a good one.
Take her easy. 3 till 12, 560, All Cowboy Radio, WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
More Sports Illustrated. It's a marathon. They got the parental warning on it. You know it's going to be good.
Hola.
Excellent day. WQAM!
Come and listen to a story about a gal named Spears. Started out wearing Mickey Mouse Club ears. Then she was a singer with really big boobs. Until she met that Federline dude. Fake rapper. Real poser. Well, the next thing you know, she's got knocked up. Got herself hitched without a prenup. Friends all said, he'd just after your cash. She turned you into sorry white trash. Trailer trash. Gary Springer. Now it's time to say goodbye to Mr. Britney Spears. Never should have gone and tried to pierce the baby's ears. Y'all had better get the kid or else he won't survive. With ignorant hillbillies that don't know how to drive. Wave bye-bye now. Don't look back now. You hear?
Okay, 1202, 560 QAM. Speaking of some old business, every once in a while we'll get these faxes that are addressed, like, to me. You know, during when Neil's doing the show, and sometimes nowhere near when I'm going to be doing a show. Here's the case in point from the Palm Beach Troublemaker. And they got, like, I got no way to respond to them. You know what I mean? Like, I'm going to interrupt Neil and say, oh, wait, I got a fax here that somebody wants, you know, is telling me something. I tried to fax him back. Look at the back of this thing. I wrote a little note back, tried to fax it back, but he was faxing it from his home phone, Palm Beach Troublemaker. And I could hear him going, hello, hello. There's no handset on our fax machine, so even if I wanted to pick up and talk to him, even if I wanted to, get it?
I get it.
If I wanted to, I wouldn't be able to. And he says, and he's taking a shot. Neil, apparently the king of all gay media. Now, what the hell is that? Is not reading my chronic faxes anymore. Maybe there's a reason for that. So this is for you. And the only reason that I'm talking about this is because it makes two points. Number one, people are so behind, it's not funny, Palm Beach Troublemaker. And number two, kindgirls.com can't get enough attention as far as I'm concerned. When the beaded curtain had to go away, we gave people all kinds of choices, especially kindgirls.com. Because remember when we stopped leaning on celebrities so much and just started putting Purdy Girls on there?
Yeah.
My main source for those pictures was kindgirls.com. Just beautiful, clean, pristine, naked girls, hot-looking, young, fresh, wonderful-looking naked girls. Kindgirls.com. Free.
Naked kind girls.
They're kind. My favorite kind. Naked. And spelled just like that with a K. KIND girls.com. Also, for people who are interested in a little bit more fun, and it's in German, like you care, Kladblog with a K, we've spoken about them before, K-L-A-D, blog, cladblog.com. They kind of cut and paste from different websites, including all kinds of naked pictures. But more important than that, I know what you're saying. What could be more important than naked pictures?
What is more important?
All right, maybe not more important, but almost as fun, is all kinds of weird videos from all over the world, like, you know, skateboarding punks and rollerblading punks wiping out hard, right? Accidents, people getting hit by trains, things that they see all the time in other countries, but our censors don't let us see it on TV. You know what I'm talking about? Kooky kind of stuff. Funny videos, weird videos, just all of these things, all kinds of things like that on a Clad blog. It's a very good, fun site. You could spend a lot of time on there. So there you go, Palmy Troublemaker. We've known about it for a long time. We've been telling people about it for a long time. You're a little slow, but at least thanks for the reminder. And you and anybody else that wants to send me a little bit of a private message, stick an email address on there if you actually want me to respond to it. That would be a way. Because I tried to fax him back. He had the fax machine number on the top of it. But like I told you, it was his home number, so that didn't do any good. QAM, hello.
You miser.
QAM, hello.
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 Hey, what's up, George?
How are you?
All right, I'm doing all right. I just caught you from the Westerns not that long ago. I wanted to ask you if you've heard of this comic book. It's called Preacher.
Creature? No.
Yeah. Well, it's very good. It's my favorite comic book of all time, better than Sin City.
Okay.
It was made in the late 90s.
By the way, I had never seen a Sin City comic book, but the box set, the latest box set with the extra added footage, blah, 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 comes with a little hardcover Sin City comic. It's the Marv story, the best one.
Yeah, it was the first one, yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
It was very good. But anyway, it's Preacher. It's about this guy who's in Texas. He's ever, and he's had a dark past, hates his life, smokes, drinks, everything. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, up in heaven, there's this big epic battle going on between, you know, good and evil, hell and heaven. During this battle, an angel and a devil fall in love and have a kid. Now, this kid's more powerful than God because it has elements of good and evil in it.
Okay.
It escapes the heavens, goes to earth, and meets to blend with the human soul. Living with this preacher, and certainly kills everyone in the church. But the preacher survives. He's got the word of God in him. He can make anyone do anything he wants. So now, since God becomes aware of his power, he decides to just abandon his post and he disappears. So now this guy has an epic adventure to try to search for God. It's amazing.
Okay, thank you very much. You think it was a coincidence that his phone was breaking up and cutting out?
Maybe that creature.
He could have stopped right there. Hey, there's this new comic called Creature. You should check it out. And then I'd say, no, I'm not, you know, I don't buy comics anymore. And what's the point anyway? If it ain't electronic, I don't have time.
Let him make
it.
A movie of it, man.
Yeah, well, I'll wait for the movie. Thank you very much. QAM, hello. Look, I still have the poll from the weekend.
Think it could get any
gayer, I know.
Here comes George.
Amazing, right? QAM, hello.
This is Eddie.
No, it isn't. QAM, hello.
Hey, what's up, George?
How you doing?
Pretty good. Hey, Spike is the best. There's 6 more years of these to go.
Oh, beautiful. Wow. I'd like to just stay here and not go home today.
Yeah, we're only up to year 2000.
Stupendous.
Yes. Isn't it wonderful?
It is wonderful. Thank you very much.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. And remember, it still cracks me up. Spike Lee sued them. Remember that?
Yeah, I do.
This used to be, what was it before, which they didn't need to change their name anyway. Oh, it was...
Wasn't it?
It started out as the Nashville Network, and then it was the American Network,
The
National Network or something like that, and that was fine. They just could have called it the American Network, TAN. How's that? And they changed it to Spike, and Spike Lee sued them. And was it The Daily Show or Saturday Night Live? Now I can't remember. That had a good line.
Both, probably.
This. They said, Spike Lee is also pursuing litigation against Lee Majors, Lee Jeans, and Lili Sobieski. What an idiot you are, Spike Lee.
Yes.
I'm sorry I've watched any of your movies after that. When I hear about crap like that, I just want to puke. Is that wrong? That makes you want to lose respect?
It's like, what's going on in your life that a network comes out with
you've
your
got
with your
mental
name.
Problems. Yeah. That's what's going on. You need help. You need therapy. You need people around you to steer you towards reality. That's what you need. QAM, hello. QAM, hello. What's with all these lines, man? Maybe it wasn't that guy's phone after all. It might be us. Wouldn't that be unusual? So I kept putting this off. Notice how I milked this. The poll from the weekend. The worst movie endings?
Yeah.
Because I knew that once we got into this, it might just take over, and that's fine. I hate this poll 232. Just sour. That's okay. typical South Floridians just, you just hate everything. That's fine. I can't wait for the day that I don't have to be around you people, you 232 people, 11.7% of the audience, anymore. If only we could find them and isolate them, you know, and put them in a camp, you know, like they did with the Japanese and like they're going to start doing with us.
Mm-hmm.
Just intern those people. Put them in a camp and let them just at each other. The Blair Witch Project won 177, and that was great. Boy, I put that on there at, like, before 8 o'clock. First thing, just so that I could vote for it, because it wasn't on there, and I wanted to vote for something when I came in that day.
Yeah.
Blair Witch Project. Bar none, more than anything. Did you see the Family Guy where they took a shot at that? Brian was a seeing eye dog, and he was narrating what was going on.
No.
It was funny. You'll catch it.
I'll catch it, yeah.
Eventually. It was spot on, as usual. Just like, Colin Farrell. I was talking to my wife, Dixie.
Did you have that?
Somewhere. And she was saying, you're not a very good actor. And I agreed with her. Why would she say that, Colin?
It was the Jiminy Glick. Yeah. Right on.
Oh, I was crying. I was wiping the tears away hard. And I'm flipping through yesterday, and Alexander's on again. Horrible. Horrible piece of filth.
You know, I keep trying to catch Rosario.
I know, and that's what I was trying to do.
I'm trying to catch it
because she's full frontal in it, and I'm lingering just long enough to catch my bearings in the movie to see if it's anywhere near that point. Not only was I not, but unfortunately, it was a scene that had him in there trying to act. How he is there is a mystery to me, unless obviously he found the avenue to success, if you know what I mean. He got a hold of some producer's part, you know, some executive producer, something, there's something going on there that doesn't meet the eye, but there it is. So Blair Witch Project, I mean, there are movie endings that made me mad, but nothing like this.
See, that's a very good pick, but I was so furious at the end of Contact.
I agree.
That got my vote, just because it was such a good movie.
And it placed well, too. You're right. It was good, and then, like, pulling a carpet out from under you.
Oh.
At least the Blair Witch Project was bad.
Yeah, it was bad the whole way through.
And then they screwed you at the end, all right? Although, I will say this, for what it was supposed to be, and I was taking it as that, for what it was supposed to be, this little low budget, you know what I mean, that turned out to be not as low budget as we were told in the first place.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like it was a good idea, and it's an original idea, and they were building the suspense, and I was getting kind of suspenseful. But then after a while, you're like, okay, I'm tired now. And then the credits start rolling. And by the way, I got the end. People say, oh, no, you just didn't get the ending. He was standing in the corner. They said that earlier, that the witch makes somebody stand, makes the one person standing in the corner while they kill the other one. It's like, I got it, all right? I didn't hate the ending because I didn't get it. It's because I did, and it was lame. Second place, War of the Worlds, and I assume that they're talking about the current version, where...
I mean, they're both the same, really.
It's kind of the same, but at least in the first version, it was a little bit more cliffhangy, a little bit more of a surprise. In the new version, they're just walking around, and they're walking around, and they're walking around, and then they're walking, hey, look, the plants are dying. Oh, look, the aliens are dying. The end. Oh, we're going to shoot one with a bazooka now that the shields are down. Oh, look, they blow up now that they're already dying. Now that we don't need to blow them up, they blow up real easy. Easy Rider 131, I guess a little abrupt, a little unsatisfactory. Okay. Not in the same league with these other ones that we're talking about, but that's okay. AI, Artificial Intelligence, 113 votes for that. Yes, absolutely. Bad ending, well, bad movie. Bad beginning, bad middle, bad end. Other than that, it was a great movie. And then here's yours, Contact, just one vote short of that, 112 votes for Contact. Great, suspense, going along fine, edge of your seat, freaking riveted, and then the big jerk. As the prayer carpet goes flying out from under you, and you fall on your face. Are you kidding me? I sat there saying, are you kidding? You're not. You didn't really just do that to me, did you?
Yeah.
Yeah, we did.
The same thing, man. I was disappointed.
Should we pre-ruin it? Should we inoculate the audience against it? It's like, basically, the whole movie is faith versus fact. Faith versus fact. Faith versus fact. And in the end, the aliens are a matter of faith.
But it turns into her dad, and, you know, it's just...
Oh, they didn't make a bag big enough for the puke that came out my nose watching that thing. Vanilla Sky, perfect example of a movie Whoever was responsible for that ending, whether it was the writer, the director, the executive producer, deserves to be beaten. I've said it before. And the movie studios, they say, no, you're supposed to come up with the ending yourself.
Yeah, I don't like that.
How about if I just save my money and come up with the beginning and the middle myself, too? That's not why I bought a ticket. I bought a ticket to see a story being told, not half of it or three-quarters of it. If you didn't see Vanilla Sky, don't. All right? What would be possibly an interesting storyline. You know what?
A couple times. And it's on the right track of being a good movie.
It's on the right track, and and he chooses to wake up, and you as the audience member, I don't know about you, but me as the audience member, I'm like, all right, he's waking up. What's he going to wake up to? Credits!
That's, yeah.
He wakes up to the credits.
Yeah.
I want to hit somebody.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
Or rather, I would want to hire a bunch of cops to hit them because they could do a much better job, as we've seen on TV recently. 12:15 on All Bad Ending Radio, 560 WQAM.
If I could offer only one tip for the future, act strange and people will leave you alone. The rest of my advice has no basis more reliable than my own meandering experience. Put a slinky around your neck and try to walk downstairs backwards head first. Sit naked in a large bowl of Rice Krispies and sing Feelings while the kernels go snap, crackle, and pop. Go up to a ticket booth and try to stick your head through the hole where they say how much. Lick a stranger. Tell them you're from Bosnia and your country, it's a sign of respect. Take lots of pills. One of them might work. Occasionally ask a stranger if they've heard anything from Lewis. Be annoying. During an IRS audit, staple the guy's hand to his desk. Moon a funeral. Play go fetch with a seeing eye dog while he's working. Run naked through a mall yelling, killer bees, killer bees. Say the word titty without smiling. Try to figure out who said Pauly Shore should star in movies. Don't be surprised if it's the same guy who said John Gacy should work with kids. Ask an old lady if you can carry her groceries and try to make a run for it. Disappear for great lengths of time. Try to touch your forehead with your tongue. It may not work, but many women will appreciate the effort. At a high school reunion, tell your old English teacher that your dog's still eating your homework. Ask Mark McGuire if he'll take $1 million for one of his balls. Try to find the secret to Carrot Top's success. Understand your conception was an accident, that your parents got wasted and wanted a few more laughs before they passed out. Try not to lose your finger in your nose. Take up Bob Costas and toss him on the lawn next door. Go on a car trip with Bob Costas and force him to stay in his car seat. Try to dribble Bob Costas. Ask all your friends and family for forgiveness. Knowing you, you've done some crap that's really pissed them off. Wish no ill will to anyone, unless you don't like them. Then screw them, they're on their own. Realize anyone who says they're completely happy are completely full of crap. Ask a Hell's Angel if he's a woman, or has he always walked like that? Understand that there are bad people in the world, and you may just be one of them. Sniff an old lady. Imagine Gomer Pyle in a gay bar trying to get lucky. Do this without laughing. Find what's left of your innocence. Understand it, embrace it, protect it, and every so often, take it out for a nice nosh. Care enough not to care. Hum while you eat. Act strange, and people will leave you alone.
1223-560 WQAM. Get back to the list in a minute here. I got a fact saying the internet stream is breaking in and out. If it is, sorry. It's just all part of the ambiance. Like, the phones are weird today. I'm not talking just the equipment stuff. Like, when we punch up a line, for example, let me punch up a line that works. We're getting that. Hear that?
Well, it's hard not to.
What is that? It sounds like a dove. So if you're listening online and it's breaking out, I don't know what that's all about. Sorry about that. Speaking of online thing, I was just noticing the little you know, our little chat box here that we have with Eric so that we can communicate back and forth. When you misspell something on the poll, we can tell him to fix it, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
And he says earlier, I didn't even read this earlier, incredible, they're playing trance/techno instead of idiotic sports spots during the breaks now. You know, we had that situation where for some reason we can't play the regular spots, copyright.
On the stream, yeah.
During the stream, so they replace that audio
with other content.
But it's other spots.
Different spots, yeah.
But according to Eric, they're using trance/techno.
Well, there's only there's probably like one or two spots, and then once they're done, it's just music plays.
I was going to say, maybe they're playing break beats during the breaks. Get it?
Ha
ha ha ha ha ha. Moving right along. Apocalypse Now. Now, what was wrong?
Sorry. Oh, you're going to regret that one.
I know. I already do. Apocalypse Now. All right. How was that supposed to end? Apocalypse Now. Now, you saw it.
Yeah, what was wrong with that?
I don't know. He went there to kill the guy. He killed the guy. The end.
Oh, you know what movie? I didn't remember to put it on the poll. I don't know if you saw it. It had a horrible ending.
Probably.
Hero with
Jet Li.
Jet Li.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
First of all, I don't like those kind of movies where they tell the same story like four different ways.
Right.
But then the whole...
It was a cop-out.
The whole reason that he sets out to do what he sets out to do, he doesn't do it.
And Right. Pissed me off. I saw it in the theater.
He basically just
killed
himself.
It was a good movie. Yeah, exactly.
Corny,
hokey, unacceptable.
Yeah.
I mean, it was an ending. See, there's two... And as a matter of fact, somebody faxed in when Neil was doing this poll last week. Are you talking... Is there a difference between a bad ending and a sad ending? In other words, are you talking about... Like a crappy ending or an unacceptable ending? Those are two different things. That's an example of an unacceptable ending. A crappy ending is like Blair Witch, where they just don't end it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or Vanilla Sky, where they don't end it. There's a non-ending. Or Magnolia, where they end some of the stories, not some of the others. As opposed to an unacceptable ending, like El Norte, for example. Don't see it.
I won't.
All right? I'm warning you. You'll regret it. Planet of the Apes, I assume they're talking about the new version, because the original version, that was a great ending.
I've seen both.
Right. Now, how old were you when you saw the original Chuck Heston version?
Probably like 12.
Yeah. Now, had anyone ruined it for you? Did you know what was going to happen?
Well, yeah. I usually do watching a movie like that.
It's so kind of... Well, I mean, you knew that they were there, but you didn't expect. I mean, I didn't expect that. I saw that with no warning whatsoever, saw it out of nowhere. You kind of suspected that they were on Earth after all.
Right.
But I didn't expect that. No one did in that day at the time. And it was like, surprise, and it was good. Great. This modern version with Marky Mark, who is a good actor, another stupid time loop.
You know.
The chimp. Why do they do that?
I didn't have a problem with it, but, you know, it was just whatever.
If I seem a little distracted, Matrix Revolutions, was that the last one?
Yeah, it was the third one.
What's wrong with that? They ended the story, thank God.
Yeah, you know, to be honest with you, I didn't really particularly like the third one.
Uh-huh, I did.
You knew that was the way that they were going to end it.
It had to, well, see, here's the thing.
That's what they were going for.
Please end it. Please end the trilogy already. See, I hated part two. Part two was the one that ruined everything else. Yeah. You know, he goes to see the guy, and there he is.
I thought...
And the guy's got a pen, and he's... telling him a whole bunch of crap. Why didn't Neo reach out and stick his fingers in his eyes? I would have done that, or at least try it.
I don't know.
It's unacceptable. Part
I
two.
Thought they started oh, going just, in a direction yeah. that I didn't really like.
Hated the whole, we've allowed the city to be destroyed a whole bunch of times and rebuilt. It's like, stop! Why are you doing that?
But they started, in my opinion anyway, they started to make it kind of like a religious thing. It looked like to me.
Right.
Like it was a Jesus. Like they were relaying it to Jesus.
Well, yeah. No,
Jesus
you know,
Christ.
Neo gave his life.
Like the first
for
one.
You.
I got to be honest with you. The first one,
sure.
I put it up there with some of the best movies I've ever seen.
Even though, and I got to do like the same thing with Matrix that I do with Terminator. All right. The whole premise here is hokey, but boy, was that a good movie.
Damn right.
Because that's how it is. The humans are a battery. Is that the best you could do? That's the best you could do to come up with.
Yeah, they're growing in fields.
And they're growing in fields, and we're fed our own feces back at us. It's kind of like the American media, but come on now. And I don't know if you noticed this, because, you know, perpetual motion is impossible. So if they're taking electricity from us, and the only fuel that we're getting is our own waste coming back at us, That's not fuel. You understand? That's a perpetual motion machine that doesn't work. So in the movie, they say this. They explain the whole human is the battery thing, right?
Yeah.
Morpheus is explaining this to Neo. This
combined with a form of fusion.
And he just blows right past that is what powers the machines. Wait a minute. Go back to the fusion part. They have fusion? They have fusion power? You know fusion?
Yeah.
When we learned in science class that a vial of seawater can light up the world for 100 years, that kind of fusion? Is that what you're talking about?
That's
limited.
That's mucho power.
Yeah, that's a lot of power. What do they need us for? Hokey. But other than that, it was a real fun movie to watch. And I hated number two, but number three was a lot of fun stuff happening, too. A lot of ship fighting,
yeah.
Which I like.
Yeah.
And all of the fights, as a matter of fact, were real good in part three, I thought. The machines fighting each other, the humans in there, I don't know what you call those things.
Oh, those, like an alien where they get
Waldos,
in.
Waldos, yeah. The little robot, remote-controlled robot things, and that whole city fight was cool. The fight with Neo and Agent...
Smith.
The Smiths. The Smiths was cool, and the ships fighting each other was kind of cool. So I liked 3 just fine, and thank God they ended it.
Yes.
Neo dying, great. That made me really happy.
Well, you, I mean, people complain about that. Oh, I've heard, oh, he shouldn't have died, but, like, what did you think was going to happen?
Yeah, he should have. Yeah, he should have. Please end it.
But you knew that.
End it. Nail it down. End it. And that way you sell the trilogy. The trilogy is, here's a 3-pack, that's it. Done, like they should have done with Star Wars. Oh, I'm sorry. 12:30 on 560 WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
What's it gonna do next? It's Quagmire.
Good morning, Americans. It's Paul Harvey. Stand by for news. Gynecologist Dr. Miller was getting sick and tired of his job and decided he needed a career change. I'll say it again. Dr. Miller, gynecologist, wanted a new job. He'd always enjoyed tinkering with engines, so thought he might become a mechanic. He went along to mechanic school, and the final test was to strip the engine completely and reassemble it back into perfect working order. Our gynecologist, Dr. Miller, friend, took the test and anxiously awaited his results. The day he received the results, he got quite a surprise. He got 150%. He quickly phoned the instructor and asked about the high mark. The instructor said, "No, that's right. First, I gave you 50% for stripping down the engine. A very thorough job. Next, I gave you 50% for reassembling it. A fantastic job. And I gave you another 50% bonus for doing it all through the tailpipe, Paul Harvey." Good day.
25 till 1, 560 QAM. Not that funny, but at least it was a minute and 4 seconds long.
Very true.
All right. Before we go through these movies, I started out talking about the Olympics this morning because I was trying to watch something that didn't have to do with the Olympics, and I got shut out on all three major networks.
Well, you can watch the Fight TV Bikini Fest.
Right, I am, but it wasn't this morning. I don't think it started. Elsa Benitez, that's who we're on right now. Who we wish we were on right now. So I'm watching, and it's just all Olympic stuff, so eventually, you know, your thumb gets tired of trying, and you got to put your pants on, so you just leave it on something, and it was Hannah Storm, the Harry Smith early show, Channel 4, I guess, is where I left it on.
Okay.
And they're interviewing Johnny Weir, who I think is a figure skater.
So
you seen this guy?
I have not.
Johnny Weir, I think they lost a D somewhere. Johnny Weird. Oh, boy.
I don't doubt it.
If those skates weren't so heavy, he'd have floated off into orbit a long time ago. I just thought I'd mention that because they were showing highlights of all kinds of things. And once again, you know, the snowboarding thing, I'd like to give that a shot. What do you say? Let's go snowboarding.
Okay. Right after we have a paintball fight.
We're going to have a paintball fight. As a matter of fact, did Rolly talk to you about that?
Yeah, he mentioned that.
He's going to try to hook that up somehow.
I'd like that.
Now, we have to, to be fair, we have to be armed similarly.
Well, just listen, I figure we get the guns that you can rent.
Right.
So we just have a marginal gun.
Oh, look at that. We'll get the same thing. As a matter of fact, that's what I'm going to do to win. I'm going to say, hey, there's also Benitez over there. Bam, 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 bam.
And then you're going to crank it up?
Yeah. Because I already told you my story of going paintball shooting with Dudley and others and these 12-year-old kids with their $1,000 repeating paintball guns with ammo, with an ammo bin is the only way that I can describe it.
One pull of the trigger, you get 30 paintballs on it.
You could actually see the line of yellow paintballs, and there was, first of all, there was no arc to it. It was just like, it looked like a laser. It was just a straight, solid shot of, fully automatic paintballs.
Oh, yeah.
And here I am with the CO2 pistol. Ding, ding. And here, and out from behind a crate pops, this 12-year-old Jesse Ventura clone with a Vulcan minigun. Paintball minigun. Painting the walls with it. He was hitting boxes. The boxes would go flying. Hit one of us, we'd go flying. No chance at all. So I'm just saying, similarly armed. All right? And you're faster, but I'm smaller, so that should work out.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
5670560 is our number. Don't be slackers just because it's a holiday. #560 is free if you have Verizon or Singular Wireless, 877-785-6345. As a matter of fact, if you have Verizon, you can probably be using one of those Palm 700s that are just out right now instead of this crappy-ass sidekick that I'm stuck with for the next 2 years. Did I mention lately what a piece of crap this thing is?
No, not lately.
Okay, it's a piece of crap. The whole sideways big keyboard thing sure is handy to type on, but if you want to use it for a phone, good luck to you. The camera sucks. It doesn't send multimedia messages.
Everyone loves it on the other side of the building.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I haven't seen anybody else with one in the building.
Well, all the Power 96 people have them.
The girls?
And the boys.
I see. I mean, and don't get me wrong, I've gotten really good at dialing, closing it, turning it upside down, and talking with it, which is what you have to do to talk on it. The audio quality is horrendous. It's got a lot of, like, little vibrating tin speaker. Now, I'd like to know if that's standard or is mine defective. In other words, if somebody in the building has one of these sidekicks, let me borrow it. Let me talk on it for a little bit to see if it's just mine. And now here's a million-dollar question. If it is mine and I send it back, because I don't know, I might still be able to, what's the warranty on these things? 3 months? One or three? What do you think? I don't know. If mine's defective.
Probably like 30 days.
Yeah, probably. I'm already screwed. But what happens to all the software I already bought, was that a Freudian slip?
Yeah.
That I already bought and put in here. You know what I mean? Like, I put some photo editing software on there, which is worthless, because the photos are crappy, so.
Yeah.
If somebody tries to send you a multimedia message with a picture in it, like you can from the Razer, for example, it doesn't go to the phone. It goes to a web page that you can't do anything with from your phone. You can just look at the picture. There it is. Hmm. Look at it. Now, if you go to that web page from your computer, you can save the picture, forward the picture along.
Now, do you have your email sent on that?
Yeah, yeah.
Sent to the sidekick?
You do two accounts. It's handy that way. But here's the thing. It doesn't use the quote-unquote push email that you've been hearing about, like BlackBerry does. No, it checks the email periodically, which means if you send me an email, I could either get it right away or 2 hours later, anywhere in between, because it goes looking for the email when it wants to. All right?
That's pretty miserable.
So it doesn't utilize push email. So, yeah, so the bottom line is it sucks. Get yourself something else. QAM, hello. Hello. Goodbye. QAM, hello.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Hey George, this is James. Have you guys done the great ending movies survey yet?
You know what? I don't know if we have, but if we haven't, even if we have, how's that?
Well, can I suggest one anyway?
Do it.
Have you guys ever seen the movie The Wicker Man?
The Wicker Man.
Yeah.
With Bridget. Wait a minute. Don't tell me. What's her blonde? She's cute. She's got those teeth.
I thought it was
naked.
Britt Eklund?
Yes, that's one. Britt Eklund. Very good. Yeah, I saw it. It's a great movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
With a very good ending. Funny.
Yeah.
Makes you laugh, doesn't it?
All right, that's all I got. All
right, we got it. We'll put that down. There you go. Ask and you shall receive, at least sometimes. Thank you. We'll do that. Best movie endings, we'll start working on that for tomorrow. Which movie had the best ending? Because I was thinking about that, too. For example, not that it necessarily qualifies for the poll, but just as a typically good ending, and we're not going to ruin it for people because there are people out there who haven't seen Outlaw Josie Wales, the fine film that it is, and what a nice, warm ending that is. Like sitting your ass in a warm tub, like,
this is a promotion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ah. Oh, after all that grief that Josie went through, this whole freaking movie, he deserves this. Ah. So we got it, Wicker Man, with the Equalizer. I forget that guy's name. But it was a good movie. You'd be surprised. Britt Eklund, I don't know if you know who that is.
Don't think so.
Hottie from the past, getting naked. QAM, hello.
Wonderful show.
QAM, hello. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, how you doing? I got a great ending movie to me is Braveheart.
Okay.
I think, I don't know, I heard you talk about Gladiator, but never Braveheart. I think that's one of the best movies ever.
I like Braveheart a lot. Seen it about five times, all right?
Yeah, and as far as The Matrix, you were talking about The Matrix earlier.
Mm-hmm.
I have to agree with you, but disagree. I like part two more than part three.
Really?
I thought part three was kind
of
weak.
Well, I like parts of part two, but I didn't like the notions that they were floating out at me.
Yeah, it started getting a little too religious, like you guys were talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Starting in part two.
I mean, why come up with that whole concept that they let the city be destroyed and rebuilt over? Like, what purpose did that serve besides making everything that they were doing worthless?
Did you see the new one?
It doesn't matter if you do lose, they're going to rebuild the city again anyway.
Have you seen the previous of that new one the Wachowski brothers are doing, the V for Vendetta? The same
yes,
guys the
yes,
Matrix.
I did. Looks phenomenal, doesn't it?
Yeah,
Josh saw it. Yeah,
it looks
awesome.
Cool. We'll see.
All right.
All right, man, take care.
I'm holding my breath. I'm reserving judgment, but
that looks really good.
I mean, you see some previews, and then there are previews, and this thing looks top-notch.
I've seen the long preview.
Do you think there are any parallels between that movie and what's going on in America today? It's just a coincidence, right?
I'm sure.
By the way, there's an irony. Did you ever wind up seeing 1984? I know we had the DVD around here somewhere.
No.
Miguel saw it. He said it was horrible, so then that means you didn't see it?
I did not.
So you should see it. Did you take it home? Because where the hell is it now?
I gave it back because you asked me.
Oh, well, I don't even know where the hell it is now. Well, you have to see it so that you don't have to read the book. For one thing.
Well, that ain't
just
happening.
To cover the material so that you can get all the 1984 jokes and all the stories that we're posting that make references to George Orwell in 1984. So just as a homework assignment. And there's a lot of hair in the movie.
You told me that.
Yeah, hairy. They don't have razors in the future. Well, that's a precious commodity. Times are tough in the future, and razors are a luxury item. As a matter of fact, they address that in the movie because he's doing some wheeling and dealing so he can get some razors to shave his face. When you realize what the guys are going through to get razors, to shave parts of their body that you can see, you can understand why the women aren't even going to the trouble at all.
Yeah.
Because they don't go to any trouble at all. But you have to see that. But in that movie, John Hurt, that is his name, right? John Hurt is the hero, all right? And in Vendetta, he's the big brother figure. So it's a little bit of role reversal there. Just thought I'd mention that. It's boring the hell out of you, I know, but...
That's all right, man.
That's my job. 15 till 1 on 560 QAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
It was a friendship that became a secret.
Well, Dan, I reckon if we're going to be retired network anchors together, we ought to start drinking together.
Oh, good idea, Tom. Bottoms up. So to speak.
There are lies they have to tell. There are truths they can't deny. On Bokaw Mountain.
You talking head sure found a way to make the time pass up there.
Oh, we're just fishing buddies.
Bokaw Mountain.
I wish I knew how to quit you, Tom Brokaw.
Love is a force of nature.
You know, Dan Rather, it could be like this. Just like this. Always.
Bokaw Mountain. Now showing a little more than you wanted to see.
10 till 1 on 560 QAM. Thank you for this, Robert. No, I don't read the local newspapers, even when they're thrown on my driveway against my will. I pick them up by the little plastic bag with just two fingers, trying very hard not to make any contact with the actual paper itself.
Is it because of that, or is it because it's all wet?
And then I throw it, that too. Mm. It's wet even if it's dry. How's that? And I throw it into the refuse bin because I refuse to look at it or touch it or dirty my fingers with it. Robert Grieper, however, reads the paper, and he printed this up for me. Thank you so much, or we would have missed it. From the JICA answer question and answer section.
What's it about?
He tipped you off, didn't he? He tipped you over, didn't he? Well, here, let's upend you. Hang on, I got dough. I'm working on my second bagel.
Short on. Short on cash.
Thanks to your girl one more time for bringing in these bagels, or we would have been, what's the term Neil uses? Up tourists or something like that?
Yeah, what does that mean?
It's Yiddish. It probably means out of luck.
Okay.
Up the creek. The question is, what happened to Howard David of WQAM AM 560? And here, ready for the funny part? I enjoyed his show many afternoons. It appears he has been dropped by the station. It seems he may have annoyed or irritated the prima donnas at WQAM. Who are they referring to?
I don't know.
I would appreciate some information as to Howard's whereabouts and if you expect him to reappear in this market, says MW via email. Jika says, David irritated more than the prima donnas. He alienated virtually everyone he came into contact with, from other hosts to producers to board operators to the promotions department. He's a superb talent at calling games, but his people skills have a lot to be retired. His contract ran until March, but the station bought him out. He will probably resurface doing play-by-play somewhere, but his talk show future in South Florida is problematical.
That's correct.
And there you go.
I'd say that's pretty right on right there.
That's right on, and there's no secret to... should I save this? I was going to throw it away, but I'll just save it over
Why
here.
Why not?
Somebody might want to talk about it later on. Joe Bell doesn't mess around and doesn't string people along who have no future, and when Howard, you know, pushed him up against the wall there, stuck him in a corner and said, you know, listen here, I'll have you know. Now, see here, you... Are you going to renew my contract or aren't you? And Joe said,
no.
No. As a matter of fact, if you want to have an answer, there it is, no. And Howard said, no, they parted very nicely. He thanked Joe for, you know, being straight up and honest when no one else had ever been before. And that's it. And he said, I'd rather not work it. And Joe said, fine, you don't have to. Here's a check. And that's it. So there you go, for those of you who don't already know, and I'm sure most of you already do. QAM, hello.
Hey, I saw the blue vet out in the driveway. Is he in town?
QAM, hello. Hello.
Hello, George.
Yes.
Hi, George.
How
Most
are you?
Prophetic movie ending ever.
Sad.
A pilot from Texas destroys the world. Dr. Strangelove.
Okay.
Is that a good one?
All right, we'll put it on there for you. I respectfully disagree, but we'll put it on there for you. How's that? I mean, it might be prophetic. I'm not going to argue that point with you. I thought that movie was very overrated.
Really?
I know I get in trouble for saying that, but still. I had high hopes when I saw that movie.
Lovers.
It was overhyped to me. I thought it was just fine, but not nearly worth what everybody gave it. So.
Mm. Everyone loves Peter Sellers in that, I think. That
I like Peter Sellers. He's always great.
End of his career.
I like the Pink Panther. I like being there more than anything.
Oh, that was great.
Yes, it was.
That was wonderful.
Uh-huh. Refreshing. Different.
Yep.
All right.
Okay, thanks, George.
Take it
thanks.
Easy. We'll put that down. I don't know. I can't write and talk at the same time. I'm going to put Dr. Strange. And you know that's going to get screwed up.
Yeah.
Not the comic book guy.
We'll turn
not
into
the Mystic Master. QAM, hello.
Yeah. George.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think that gets ignored in all these movie polls are westerns. And I'd love to see you have a poll one day for the best western. But in the meantime, if you're going to do the happy endings poll...
Well, not happy, just best. It doesn't have to be happy. It just has to be satisfying. How's
that? Oh, all right. Well,
good,
the most
you know.
Dynamic ending happened to be the western, which was the Wild Bunch.
All right, I don't think I saw it, but I'll put it down for you, all right?
Okay.
The Wild Bunch.
Right.
Not to be confused with The Wild Things, which we all saw. And I'm writing this down wrong. You saw Wild Things, of course, Josh, right?
I did.
How many times?
About 30.
Yeah, I was going to say, every time it's on?
Yeah.
How often has
it
been on? Every single time it's been on, I watched it. QAM, hello.
Hello.
Hello, George.
Hello.
The worst movie ever made with a bad ending, although it's the only ending for that movie. Did you ever see Bad Lieutenant with Harvey Keitel?
Yeah.
What a waste of 80, 90, whatever it is, 96 minutes. I mean, the movie goes
I understand
on.
That when they show it on cable, they don't show my favorite part, which is when he pulls those two girls over. You know,
yeah.
That was hysterical and creepy.
Yeah, and he's dead, and that's it.
Yeah.
A bad end or a bad guy?
Should have been on the list.
Okay.
All right, take it easy. I wonder, was he the inspiration for Vic Mackey? Well, I can't wait till Tuesday. What's Vic going to do? Are you up to date on the Shield there, Josh? Are you all
I'm caught? Not, no.
Oh, boy. Catch up. Forrest Whitaker, man. He's driven.
I need to.
He's smart. He's smart. He knows all the cop rules.
I know what's going on because I always catch the preview.
He knows how to bend and twist people.
I know he's trying to.
He put the twist on Mackey's wife. What a stupid bitch she is, because I said I was going to talk about her. What a stupid bitch. I know it's part of the plot. It's the way it has to go. It's all, you know, a dramatic element right there. But she's a stupid bitch. It wouldn't look if someone was giving you a bag of money for you to spend on your special needs children. All right. Not only would I not ask where it came from, I wouldn't care if it had blood on it from a human head that was inside on top of the pile of money. All right. I just brush the head right aside there and say thank you. I'm gonna start. You know, I'll put this money in the tub.
Yeah,
and see what, you know, how much of the blood I can get out of it here. And I wouldn't be saying jack to anybody. And Forrest Whitaker's telling her, if you go to jail, is Mackey going to take care of those kids? You bet your sweet ass he's going to. Mackey's going to take care of his own kids, even if he has to kill some people to do it. Right? Even if he has to kill a whole bunch of Armenians and steal their money to do it, he'll take care of his own kids.
That's right.
Because Mackey, if nothing else, takes care of business. This stupid bitch, just because she thinks he knocked up that she cop. What's that got to do with the man who's coming forth with the money for the private schools for your special needs children? He could have knocked up the whole cop shop.
Good point.
All right? And she's buying into Forrest's, you know, BS. Only because they wrote it in the script. You know, because normally everybody that does things in that show, they do everything that makes sense. You know what I mean? You don't have to suspend disbelief or anything like that for the Shield. Everybody's doing exactly what is in their character to do. And still they surprise you all the time on that show. But I thought, no, come on. This bitch isn't going to side with this guy, this lying cop, this, you know, when the kids are at risk. He gave me a bag of money. You stupid bitch, keep your mouth shut when somebody gives you a bag of money. For Christ's sakes. She was the one that was harping to him in the first place. The kid's autistic, the other kid's autistic, we need to get into this private school. Is this Estella Warren on Spike TV right now? Is that who that is?
Yes, it
is. Showed me her ass. All of these things. 2 till 1 on 560 QAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Channel 56!
QAM. Nobody cares. As a matter of fact, let's take a look to see exactly, at least as far as this audience is concerned. 725 votes right now. How much do you care about the Olympics? Not at all. 265. That's a whole 36.5%. A little, 190. Somewhat, 134. Hey, listen to my pain in the ass sidekick going off here.
What's going on with that? What is that?
That's I got a voicemail from somebody calling me in the middle of the show. Speaking of the show, somewhat, 134. I only care about the Summer Olympics, 39. A lot, 33. I hate this poll, 32. And what are the Olympics, 32. So, you know, there's a controversy going on? Of course not, because you weren't stuck watching that crap this morning like I was. The men's speed skating, the black guy that got the medal, the one that looks like a donut, one that looks like a sliced in half bagel, spray painted gold, big as a hubcap. Apparently his teammates were all mad at him because he didn't run the relay. He wanted to keep himself fresh for the individual race, which he won. So now his teammates hate him. It's a controversy. See, I knew you'd care.
Well, damn him.
Yeah, right. You know, it's like... John says Shawshank Redemption for the poll. Okay.
See, I like that movie.
I like that movie fine, but it was overhyped to me. And everybody, it was very mild. I liked all the people in it. Everybody in it was phenomenal. There's nothing wrong with it. It was just, it was very mild and I got to say, a little bit predictable. Like, everybody's like, oh, surprises. There were no surprises in that movie. Really?
No. But you know what? What movie do you really not know what's going to happen? Besides the few that...
Yeah, well, that's exactly the question here. Besides, well, first of all, Braveheart is a historical drama, so you knew that Robert Bruce was going to take up arms in the end. No matter what he did during the movie, since he's the one credited for liberating Scotland from England, you knew that before this movie ends, this guy here is going to have to charge the English at some point. So when you see him standing there, you know he's going to go.
By the way, speaking of just movies and just, you know, sitting there watching my Comcast, is Mad Max on, like, every day?
Dude.
Because it is.
They must have gotten a deal. They gave it away or something. Yeah. Every freaking day.
Every day.
Bobo. Johnny.
Yeah. Every day I turn it on and I just see the glasses.
All right.
And I'm like...
And I wouldn't mind. Like, I want to hear the original audio, even if I can't understand a freaking word. It still pisses me off to this day, because we've talked about this before. We like those gritty English-type accents, really gritty Scottish, the kind of accents that they had in Snatch.
Gritty, as long as you get what they're saying, but, you know, barely.
Oh, speaking of that, I saw the updated version of Bridge on the River Kwai remake.
I don't know what that is.
Starring the guy that was in Trainspotting. I don't know his name. Robert Carlyle. I lied. It was okay. You know, it's just, whatever. It was okay. So we added Shawshank Redemption, Wild Things. Here's what we have for best movie ending. We're going to start building this poll and put it on I don't know when. See, I think that we're not going to get enough movies to stick it on there tonight like Neil does.
Let's put we'll it for tomorrow. I'm sure this will be a good for everyone, like a favorite, but The Sixth Sense.
Okay.
You know.
I want to thank my friend Freak Boy for ruining that for me before I got a chance to see it, to see if I could possibly figure it out before the end. You know, so I'm sitting there all the while knowing what's going to happen. And we won't ruin it for people because, unlike most M. Night Shyamalan Ding Dong movies, this one has a chance of being good if it's not ruined
for you. You know what's funny, too? Because wasn't that his first movie?
I think so.
Yeah.
He's going
backwards. First one was good. And then we just...
maybe that's it. Maybe he's like a musician. You know, he starts out strong and just keeps going downhill from there until...
He had that one-hit single.
Yeah. I don't care what anybody says. Indestructible, was that the name of it?
Which one?
The one with Bruce Willis and Samuel L. Jackson, who's in every movie that ever
made. Oh, no, Unbreakable.
Unbreakable, sorry. Somewhere along those lines. Yaw, yaw, yaw. Great idea.
Yeah. It was all right.
Oh.
I tell you what, that's definitely his second best to his movies, though.
That ain't saying a lot.
No, it's not.
Excellent idea, wasted. Just like Blair Witch. Great idea, wasted. Can't do it again now, at this point.
The Village was the worst movie.
All right. So, how about... Yeah, it was. How about this for Unbreakable? Instead of him hugging the guy into unconsciousness. Which I still can't get over.
They call him Mr. Glass.
How about this? Since he knows he's unbreakable, he hugs the guy and then takes a flying leap through the window from, like, the 10th story or something like that because he knows that he's going to be cool. How funny would that have been?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that have been better? And there's a big splatter on the ground and he wakes up, dusts himself off, and goes walking off into the rain. With the rain washing the blood off of him. Wouldn't that have been better? Come on, M. Night.
It would have been pretty cool.
Right there. I could have just saved your movie for you, but you didn't ask me. I put on one of my favorites, even though it might not be the one that I vote for. I can't let this poll happen without putting this on here, because I thought it was just such a sweet, good ending, and that's RoboCop, which I know you're not going to argue. Seriously, in the theater, people stood up and did the hoo-ha thing.
Yeah.
There were people, and I was one of them, and I just wanted to jump up and shout. There we go. It took a little too long, but nevertheless. It's one of those things that you should have seen it coming, but you didn't. Did you? Speaking of surprising, it's like you knew that RoboCop was going to win in the end.
Right.
You just didn't know how, and did you know when that dilemma presented itself that that's how it was going to resolve?
No.
No. No. I'd forgotten completely. Forgotten completely. It made perfect sense.
Yeah.
Right? Not that there was anything wrong with the whole movie all the way through.
Me and you would totally agree that. Yeah. I think that's one of the most underrated movies.
Totally. Totally underrated. Fun from the very beginning. Scene one.
There's no there's no setup there.
No. They just launched right into it.
Yeah.
And it's good from beginning to end. Every scene in between. QAM, hello.
Hello. George.
Hey.
How about the game for your poll?
The game?
The game.
Which version, which movie are we talking about?
The Michael Douglas, right?
Yes, yes.
Did I see that? Who else was in
there? I don't know.
Come on, look into my brain and tell me if I saw it. Give me the synopsis without ruining the end.
Okay, his brother.
Oh, the birthday present, the game thing. Okay.
All right.
That was all right. Thank you. You know what was wrong with that movie? Is that I thought, is this about this? From the very beginning, I thought, is this going to end this way? And I thought, nah, that would just be too hokey, and then it did.
Yeah. Neil bugged me, but I thought it was very marginal.
Yeah.
But whatever.
Yeah, we'll put that on there. Please, all we want are names. QAM, hello.
George, what's going on? I got one for you, Paul.
And the ability, we want to argue about every single suggestion that you make, too. Hello, yeah, go ahead.
I got one. It's an older movie. It's actually called the Aaron Gill flick. I don't know if you remember that.
No.
And it's like a little poor boy used to work for UPS. He met was marrying Nina Castell.
Nope.
Don't remember that?
Never heard of it.
Oh, man, you got to check that out. Aaron Gill.
Aaron Gill?
Aaron Gill.
Okay.
All righty, have a good one.
All right, take it easy. Aaron Gill, are we writing that down? Hey, keep an auxiliary chart over here, would you? QAM, hello. Hello. Goodbye. QAM, hello.
George, what's up, man?
Hey, how you doing?
Listen, I know you're probably going to get pissed because I always call a day too late to try and get in the worst ending ever, but give me a chance.
Well, it is too late, but we'll talk about it anyway, all right?
Return of the Jedi, man. Return of the Jedi.
Okay.
Should
I'm not going to argue with you.
Cut the end out completely, thrown in the dumpster, and then stop right there, man. The Ewoks throwing rocks at Stormtroopers.
Look, you know, they were supposed to be Wookiees, and then George Lucas, for some reason, that disease that he got, where he wanted to kiddify Star Wars, that's when you started to see the first examples of this disease that took over his brain.
Yep,
when he turned the Wookiees into Ewoks. Now, I will say because I hated them too, but at least they got blown up a lot.
Yeah.
All right?
You know what? Even as a kid, I was maybe 12, 13 years old, and I knew that sucked.
Look, I tried to explain it to George Lucas, but he wouldn't listen to me. I said, kids don't like things that are made for kids as much as they like things that are made for adults. Kids know when you're insulting their intelligence and when you're targeting things to them, and they don't like that.
They totally messed it
the
up.
Kids love all of the other Star Wars movies, and none of that stuff was targeted to a kid. There was no kiddie crap in the first two.
Yeah,
so there's no reason to bring kitty crap into any of the other stuff.
Even Return of the Jedi, when it started, it was the baddest of all three of them, the beginning. And then
they
just screwed it up, man. But anyway, dude,
still,
I finally got that off my tank, man.
Hope you feel better, but, you know, it's nothing. See, compared to the other three, it's great.
Yeah, oh, no, absolutely.
Best space fight.
Compared to the last three, I'll take that. I think Ewoks throwing rocks.
Ewoks notwithstanding, if you take the Ewoks out, it had the best lightsaber fighting. It had the best spaceship fighting.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And again, without the don't just pretend. Put your thumb over the Ewoks for a second. Kate Moss is in a wet see-through shirt. That's got nothing to do with this conversation. Just thought I'd throw that out there. The whole Darth death was great.
Yeah. All right. You're right, dude.
Okay.
Hey, take it easy, man.
No problem. You know, and if that's the price I got to pay, is putting up with teddy bears. For all the other good stuff, okay. You know, he should have stopped right there. This is such a phenomenal freaking
And what's
show.
Even more phenomenal is it's going to go the entire show today.
Woo!
Because we only got one more episode, you know.
And I started out bummed. After this one. Started out bummed about having to come in here today. Got some nice, fresh, doughy bagels from your girl. Got this action on the TV over here.
A lot of yeast.
What do you mean by that? This poll idea that just presented itself, which I'm sure we've done before, but what the hell?
Which, by the way, City of God for a good ending.
City of God.
City of God.
City of God. Very good. We'll write that down there. 114, 560, QAM.
I'm not trying to seduce you.
Oh, Dickie, what have you done? Take the trigger and massage your fragile. Gone. Janie's got a gun. Janie's got a gun.
Ow!
Story would have been more fun. You'd have shot him in the bone.
You are grounded for a month.
Janie's been disarmed.
Oh, man, you are so grounded.
No cause for alarm.
There's nothing to see here.
All quail were unharmed.
President Bush has declared war on the bird.
Janie's got a gun.
Run away like all the others.
Janie's got a gun.
Run away, run away, run away, run away.
Janie's got a gun.
I think that would be extraordinarily dangerous.
Janie's got a gun.
120 on 560 WQM. Got lots of stories about that whole gun thing. We'll get into that, I guess, during the week sometime, maybe. We'll do that today, but we got to get some names on this poll. So I'll, you know, I got some canned hunt stuff. As a matter of fact, if you go on NeilRogers.com, vote on the poll, and, you know, we have the Dick Cheney shooting game on there. You'll notice that a link appears after you shoot.
Try to hit the quail.
Yeah. Then it links you to this here story about all the canned hunting that he does. This man, just so you know, and I don't consider myself a real hunter. I was a very pea poor hunter the 3 years in a row that I tried hunting. There's more to hunting than shooting. I'm a great shot. I can shoot a target that's standing still and right in front of me. It's finding the game that is difficult. That's why it's called hunting. Hunting as in looking around, trying to find it. That's what the challenge is. I couldn't find a deer if I was on it. All right? In all my 3 years of hunting, and it wasn't for lack of trying or being out there enough, boy, my brother-in-law dragged my ass out there every single chance he got. I saw, and here's the thing, in Montana, you see deer in your front yard almost every day, all right? Deer are walking through town. Like, you see the story about the moose on the loose over here on the news lately? One of these northern towns had another moose on the loose. We had that kind of crap going on all the freaking time.
I'm sure.
You know, you'd come out to get in your car in the morning, and here'd be all these deer in your front yard, and they would skitter off as soon as they saw you. Hunting season, if I had a gun in my hand, you couldn't find a deer anywhere like 100 miles from me. And I would go out hunting with all these guys, and some of them, you know, my friends, my brother-in-law's friends, people I wanted to impress, you know, have them think I'm a manly macho kind of guy. And it sure wasn't for lack of trying, but I couldn't find a deer. I saw one running away from me once. In other words, it saw me first. And the only reason that I saw it is because when it started running, it made that, you know, hoof stomping sound as it went leaping off into the brush. And I saw its ass fading off into the brush away from me really quickly. And I know you're going to say, hey, why didn't you take a shot at it?
Why don't you take a shot at it?
Because hunter safety rule number one is be sure of your target and beyond, Mr. Cheney. All right? You don't go shooting into the brush, or you don't go shooting in the direction of an animal unless you're sure that there isn't a person anywhere near the animal or behind it.
And you don't even go hunting that often.
Right. But everyone who hunts, but hunting is what he was doing, this canned hunt stuff. Saying that you, participating in canned hunts and saying that you're hunting is like walking deli into the butcher shop and shooting a piece of meat in the display case and saying you're going hunting. All right? You can't claim to be a, a, a man. You don't have man parts if that's what you're doing. And we have canned hunt places here in Florida. When you drive up to, like, whatever, if you're going to Disney World or the in-laws' house up in Fort Wyatt or just on I-95 on the way to your house in North Carolina, whatever, you'll see these signs for these ranchers and stuff like that, these canned hunting places. These are for people with no genitalia, all right? These are for fake human beings. These are for subhumans. Why don't you go to the zoo, all right, and shoot an ostrich in a pen? Because that's exactly what you're doing. You children. You know, as a matter of fact, that's an insult to children everywhere. But we'll be talking about that as the days go by, I'm sure. And there's lots of stories. That's what got me to that. Lots of stories posted, including from other hunters on there. And read one of my favorite stories that we posted today is Rumsfeld urges using media to fight terror. In other words, the propaganda that we're getting on TV is not enough for Rummy. He thinks that we should be waging a more aggressive information campaign. How do you like that, Josh? Jonathan, got your facts. The answer to your question is Computer Concepts Corporation. If you'd stick an email on your facts, I could answer your questions off the air, but nevertheless. And as far as me being a part of your internet show, you understand that that is not going to happen because I don't own myself. The company does. We don't go on to other people's radio shows when, you know, the company owns you the way that it does. QAM, hello.
They're not going to pick up again, man.
QAM, hello. You're right. You're not going to pick up again, man. In a room full of people. Hey, it's a holiday. Right? Isn't that the excuse? Is it raining outside? Was it another nice day like it was Saturday
window.
And Sunday? Yeah. What a beautiful freaking weekend it was, right?
Yeah, it really was.
Do you notice I'm a little bit more tan today than you've ever seen me?
Look, me too. Seriously.
I got stuck. We were at Bass Pro Shops, and Miguel picked a nice shady spot, and then the sun moved. The nerve of the sun to move. And then all of a sudden, for the last half of the appearance, we're standing in the sun, and I didn't bring my big old sun hat, you know?
Mm.
The one with the leather strap on it. I said strap on. So I got my head kind of cooked over here on the left side. I'm tan on this
side
of my face. Yeah,
two-face.
That's right. I'm tan over here on this side. So if you're going to take my picture, make sure you get the tan side over here. And then we went to the park on Saturday. What's wrong with dirtbag people? We go to a little kiddie park. I'm not going to say where, in East Hollywood. To take the little kid to the little kiddie park where the sand is clean and a nice playground. And here comes carload of scum. Carload of filth. Boom, boom, boom music. And don't think that I'm talking about anybody of any particular color, because every color came out of that car. All right? Every shade. From pasty white to inky black. All right? The Hutu, the Tutsis, they were all there in the car with their whelpy children, their miscellaneous children, and dogs. See, this is what I'm getting to. Dogs are not allowed in this park, but they bring the dogs to run around the park and, you know, and bother people and make doo-doo in the park where children play. Scum, filth. So I got a little bit of sun there, too, chasing the kid around the sand. QAM, hello.
Hey, George.
Hey, what?
You know, I wanted to touch on something earlier. You were talking about the BSO deputy that got killed and everything.
Yes.
And you were wondering, and I agree with you, a lot of the stuff that they do as far as pulling up people over is really ridiculous and stuff like that. But I don't know if you know, they were driving an unmarked police car, and what happened was is the person that they pulled over accidentally swerved at them, well, of course, accidentally, whatever,
mm-hmm.
and was driving erratically, and that's the reason why he pulled him up. So, I mean, it's really...
Amen. That's exactly what a cop should pull you over. It was the speed traps that I have a problem with.
No, you're right. I have a problem with the speed trap, and I 100% agree with you. They only
see, we drive the highways all the time, and we see these people driving like dill holes every minute of every day. And like, where's a cop when you need one? That's what we always say to ourselves. So if this guy was driving, you know, in a messed up way, he deserved to be pulled over and everything. And you know, don't get me wrong. It's just, you know, when we hear the stories, you know, our initial reaction isn't the same as when we find out that it was, you know, that he had a guy pulled over.
Oh, you're right, and I agree with you. You know what I was going to tell you? You know what I think they should start enforcing again? Why are you going to drive 45 miles an hour in the left-hand lane? They don't enforce that. They don't enforce the people that run the red lights. And when they don't enforce it, people just take advantage of it. If they had cops doing that, man, I'd go out there and buy them a soda.
Yeah, I would. I you're absolutely right. A bottle of water soda. Over here on Ives Dairy and I-95 on the overpass, which is one of the ways that I go home, it's gridlock in the afternoon. If you're there after 3 o'clock, it's gridlock because nobody's stopping for any red light, and so they're backed up blocking the intersection in every direction. And I'm sitting there going nuts, and in the pack of cars going through the red light, there's a cop. There's a Metro cop. There goes a BSO. At least once a week, I see a cop in the pack of cars running the light. So you just throw your hands up in the air, you know, and shake your derriere like you just don't care. I mean, what are you going to do? You know, if the cops aren't obeying the freaking red lights, then what chance, they're the ones that are supposed to be an example.
You know, it would be cool, George, if we could turn on a special button on our car, and we could turn our car into a police car and pull that guy right over. But, you know, cop over. But we can't. So you know what we do? Keep smoking and keep loving.
Let's mount a camcorder on there and videotape that like the cops do. How's that?
Yeah.
Send it to Channel 6.
There you go.
All right.
They got their videotaping girls in D-strings on their cameras.
That's right. Hey, I got a name for it. It could be a TV show. Instead of vigilantes, they're vigilantes. Get it?
That's right.
Vigilantes. We use the cameras as a weapon.
All right, man. Take it easy.
And keep smoking. 128 Tobacco on 560 WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
I don't even think we can play this anymore. Sorry, not what I meant to fire off.
Supposed to know. My name is Britney Spears. In one hand, Preston, in the other, my cup of Joe.
Hey, everybody, what's up?
Made it difficult to see here. Show me how to use a car seat for my baby. Cause I need to know now. My stupidness. It's killing me. There's too much stress with my baby. The paparazzi made me lose my mind. Keep me confined. Take my baby. I can't drive.
All right, I don't know who keeps calling me during the show. Obviously, nobody that knows me. You ever get that?
Yeah.
I mean, I know that people bring that phone all the time, but they use some judge. Well, maybe not. They never did when I sat in that room. People that supposedly know better. It's like, do you know what I do? Have we not had this conversation? 25 till 2 on 560 WQAM. This is a really wonderful marathon. Thank you for finding this. Thank you for having your girl bring bagels in this morning. By the way, when's her show start? She's on the money, boy. Matter of fact, she could do TV show. Just dress her up, right?
Mm-hmm.
She could be on TV because she's got a great sense of humor. You know, we're going over the show this morning, and I'm going through the notes here talking about I brought up how to make, you know, my wife think that I'm having an affair and everything because she knows. And my line was, you know, my wife knows that I'm not going to find anybody to have an affair with because they're just tough to find. And your girl says, no, they're not. There's all kinds of girls out there that'll have an affair with guys. And I'm like, with me kind of guys? She's like, oh, you? No. Not like you kind of guy. I'm like, oh,
what kind of show?
That's what I'm talking about, bitch. And by bitch, I mean lovely, wonderful, warm
girl who brought us donuts.
Bagel and coffee, donut bringing girl. QAM, hello. Yo. One of these days I'll finish this poll. You know, I got down to option number 10, I think. Hello.
Hello, George.
Yeah.
Hey, how's it going, man? Julio from Hialeah. How's it going, man?
Well, you wouldn't have had to say the Julio part.
You knew about it already, right?
Yeah, we're on top.
Hey, I want to throw a vote in for that movie that you were called earlier on, Aaron Gill and Nina Castile.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a porn from like the 1970s, I think.
Okay.
It's a great movie. You gotta try to.
Aaron Gill is the name of it.
Aaron Gill and Nina Castile porn.
All right.
Yeah, try to look. It might be
porn from the 70s.
What was that?
Porn from the 70s.
From the 70s.
So it's got a lot of hair.
Yes, a lot
yeah,
of
I imagine.
Shaving involved on that one.
Right.
So
all right.
Try it. It might be on DVD already. They might have remastered it or something.
All right, I'll wait for the book.
All right, cool. Thank you.
All right, take it easy. I don't know about the old 70s porn. That's scary in retrospect. Hairy and scary.
Mustache ride.
Woo! QAM, hello. Hello.
George?
Yeah?
Hi, I'll have an affair with you.
Oh, really? Well, send a picture. QAM, hello. Hello? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Hey, did you see Lord of War?
Lord of War.
Yes.
I don't think so.
With Nicolas Cage?
I don't think so.
Great, great flick. Saw it this weekend.
Okay.
And it shows really how corrupt our government is. You should check it out. It's really, really good.
Is it like in theaters now or something?
No, it's on DVD. It kind of had like a soft release in theaters because it's really a well-made movie. I guess W there kind of suppressed it.
Lord of War.
Yeah. It's about gun running around the country, the world.
Heard about it. Somebody called in and was telling Neil about it.
Very good flick, man. Check it out.
I wrote it down on the list. We got a little bit of a network going over here.
A little bit.
Well, everybody has been accumulating movies, both legally and illegally, and so we share. Speaking of sharing, I really do hope Tony the Tiger finds that interview, since we were there in the same little room when he was telling me the story about how he interviewed Bernard Sumner from New Order. Tony the Tiger and I are both big New Order fans. Thank you to the listener, whoever it is. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to start writing people's names on the DVDs that they bring in.
Mm-hmm.
Like the dude that turned us on to Irreversible. How much mileage did we get out of that and still today?
Jeez.
All right. The guy that dropped off 24-hour party people.
Oh, that was somebody who dropped it off?
That was a listener that started a whole chain reaction of stuff. Me rediscovering Joy Division, getting into a lot of good music, and then Tony the Tiger heard us talking about it, and Robert over here from Power 96, and we've been passing this movie around, like my wife, and he saw it and loved it, and he brought me the New Order story over here that I'm going to be watching when I get a chance.
Burn that out. I'll check that out.
Burn a copy of it.
24-hour party people.
Cool. Spawned him telling me his New Order story, which is when he was interviewing Bernard Sumner. That's all part of the story, too, because he says, so Bernard, who was very effed up at the time, goes, it's Bernard. He's like, sorry, Bernard. It's all part of the story. And I'm not going to tell you how it ends. Speaking of great endings, right? That's what an interview is all about. It's those kinds of interviews that we want to see. We don't want to see these canned ones where everything goes exactly according to everyone's plans. Nah.
This is true, especially with those kind of
boring. No,
this is the meat we want.
And so come on, Ira, Tony. Come on, Tony. I don't want to say his real name on the air. Bring it in. I did add a couple options to this poll. Here's what we have so far, and we can talk about the old one for the rest of the week, the bad movie endings. I'm going to milk this for the rest of the week, I think.
Okay.
Because we need to get some names on before tomorrow. Or we can do this all during the show tomorrow. Here's what we have so far. Wicker Man, which was the first one. If you haven't seen it, it's very good. And Britt Eklund. Is it Britt Eklund?
Yeah, that's it. I looked her up, by the way. Nice.
She's a hottie. Yes. Very nice. Big lips. Nice turned up little nose. And did I mention she's naked in this movie?
Like I said.
All right. Naked doing a sexy dance.
Love the sexy dance.
Right. Wicker Man, Braveheart, Doctor Strange, these are best movie endings. And by best, I don't mean a movie that just had a satisfactory movie ending, where it just ended and you're like, weren't pissed off. We're talking an ending that made you want to go, yeah! Made you want to stand up in your seat in the theater and go, oh yeah, that's what I'm talking about, that kind of thing. Right?
Yeah.
Wicker Man, Braveheart, Doctor Strange, Love. Look, I did what I said I was going to do. Doctor Strangelove and blah, blah, blah. Wild Things.
It's a goodie.
Goodie. Shawshank Redemption. RoboCop. We'll put an asterisk next to that. The Sixth Sense of the Game. City of God. And then I added Gone with the Wind and Silence of the Lambs. Silence of the Lambs is a perfect example of what we're talking about. Because after the main storyline ends and you got the little epilogue, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
The guy on the phone.
Yeah.
He's, you know, Jodie Foster's on the phone with Hannibal Lecter. You know, I'm not going to ruin it for people because if you haven't seen
Everybody's seen that movie.
Everybody's seen Silence of the Lambs?
Yeah.
Then if you have, then you know what we're talking about. The way that ends, you know, Hannibal hangs up and he's like, I'm going to have a friend for dinner.
Yeah.
That was funny.
Yes, it was.
Leaves you laughing. You're walking out of the theater laughing. Ah, ha, ha, I get it. That was a joke. QAM, hello.
George.
Yeah.
How's it going, man?
Just fine. How are you?
Oh, pretty good, pretty good. The guy's name is Tony El Tigre.
See,
but anyways, whatever happened to revolving door after from 2 to 4?
Door from 2 to 4. As a matter of fact, I kept forgetting it's Goldie today.
Can we make some petitions and just try to bribe a mandate to come from 2 to 4?
You can take up a collection and see if you can meet the price.
Jesus Christ, anything is better than what you got
Jesus Christ.
Before.
Don't think that management isn't fretting and wringing their hands about this situation. Everyone's doing everything that they can to get that nailed down, but, you know.
All right, Antonio El Tigre.
All right.
Later.
Take it easy. He's got a big following in the Latin community, don't you know? QAM, hello. You didn't know?
No.
Well, you do now. QAM, hello.
Hey, George.
Hey, yeah.
How you doing?
Fine.
Talk about a movie that really had a strange ending. Did you see Laurel Canyon?
No.
With Francis McDormand. I'm not good with names.
McDormand, no.
Yeah, and the one who played the new Batman, Bale, Christopher Bale. That really had a strange ending. I mean, it was such a cool movie.
Laurel Canyon?
Laurel Canyon. She was his mother. She's a rock and roll record producer.
No, it doesn't ring any bells. Is it a good movie? Should I see this movie?
Oh, great. Girl kissing and getting it on with her.
Well, that's
everything.
All I need to know.
That's what Greeper just came in and said. Kate Beckinsale.
Girls kissing.
And,
yeah, rent that movie.
Kate Beckinsale and who?
Francis McDormand.
Francis McDormand do some kissing. Wow.
Yeah.
Francis.
It's a very cool movie.
You go,
very
girl.
Cool. Very, very good. About this young square couple. He's very square. Oh. And
hey, I'm sold.
They give him to hedonism is what it is. They just give
hedonism?
Him to hedonism.
Is it good hedonism?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
My favorite.
Okay.
There's nothing worse than bad hedonism, I'll tell you what. 16 till 2 on All Hedonism Radio. How many times can we say that before the break? Hedonism. WQAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Can't think of anything to say.
Father of the Bride, Cheaper by the Dozen, and the Pink Panther. They all have one thing in common. They're all bad remakes starring Steve Martin.
Excuse me!
Now, Hollywood's biggest hack is back with the Steve Martin Remake Collection, featuring classic films rehashed as only Steve Martin can, like Gone with the Wind.
Frankly, my dear, excuse me!
Taxi Driver.
Are you talking to me? Well, excuse me!
Titanic.
Excuse me! I'm king of the world!
Buy the Steve Martin Remake Collection today, and then do as Steve Martin does and buy it again, and again, and again, and again, and again.
13 till 2, 560 QAM. Now, I put Gone with the Wind here on this list, but you haven't seen it, right?
And I'm not going to. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, come on.
No.
It took me years to see it.
I'm all set.
It's got amputation.
Yeah, but...
It's got this.
Don't cut!
This is from Gone with the Wind.
Don't cut!
How can you miss a movie that's got that in it? And the doctor's sawing on his leg while that's going on there, too. Arr. I didn't think I would like Gone with the Wind. I put it off my whole life. This is one of those movies that was on TV every 5 minutes growing up, you know? And I did away with it, and the wife, I don't know, threatened me with something, you know, cutting it off while I'm sleeping, a la John Wayne Bobbitt or something like that. They were replaying it in the theaters at the time. And she just threatened my life, and I said, all right, you know, I need to make you happy, like most of the other things that I do, just to make you happy. I went and saw it, and I thought it was great.
Hmm.
Phenomenal, right to the end, and it belongs on here, man. By the time, and you've seen that line delivered, the frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn line.
Mm-hmm.
By the time he throws that line out there, you are so fed up with her. And you're wondering what the hell has gotten into you, Rhett. Because Rhett, he's the guy to like, man. You like Rhett. You'll like him. He's cool. He says all the right things, does all the right things, except for he gets all wound up about Scarlett. It's like, come on, Rhett. Can't you see she's a hoe? Can't you see she's using you? She married that guy for his money. Come on. But you know how guys get stupid over women all the time? That's Rhett's story, man. That was the chink in his armor was Scarlett O'Hara right there. So by the time he delivers that line, you just want to do a, oh, yeah. Oh, wait.
Oh, yes.
That's exactly what you want to say. Talk about standing up in the theater. One of these days when it comes on TV or something like that on cable, if it's on AMC or something, we got, like, the video of it, if you ever had 3 hours. It's very good. It's 4 stars. Trust me. I didn't think I'd like it either. It's got violence.
You know why I'll never see it?
Why?
Because, what is it, from, like, the 30s?
Yeah. We talked about this. 40s
I know,
sucks.
But I
the
just 40s can't.
Sucks, but this is a masterpiece of movie making. Not to mention that every comedy show eventually has a Gone with the Wind joke in it. It starts out all flowers and sunshines and the gala balls and the hoop skirts and all this stuff, and then you know the Civil War happens, so there's violence and tragedy and angst and all this stuff. But if for no other reason, if you don't want to see it because Rhett is cool, you got to see it because of Mammy. You got to see Mammy. Mammy will have you holding your sides for. for hours, all right? Scarlett O'Hara's Mammy.
I can...
Dude.
See, I think of the Dave Chappelle show. Yeah. On it, talking about Mammy.
Mammy is a trip, all right? You'll want a Mammy after seeing this, trust me. QAM, hello.
George, you used to...
QAM, hello. Hello.
George.
Yeah.
Hey, did you have the Usual Suspects on your good movie ending?
Excellent choice. We do now.
That movie's made by the ending. The movie is okay. So
that's how a movie should be made. Start out with a good ending and work backwards.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
that's exactly what I'm talking about. When you see that, right.
Like, you got to see it. And I watch it, I'm like, it's okay. And then the end, I'm like, oh.
Whoa, you want to sit down. You just want to sit down and put a cold compress on your head. Whoa, and take it all in.
Yeah, and afterwards is when you get all the Kaiser Soze.
Right, exactly. Exactly.
Kaiser Soze.
And the reaction that you're having is exactly the same reaction as the cop when he drops his coffee and when he finally puts it all together.
Exactly. And whatever,
yeah, you're just like that guy.
Kobayashi. Yep.
Yeah. All right.
All right, man. Later.
Take it easy. Perfect choice. See, these are the kind of choices we want on here. And we don't want this, like, lopsided poll. Who do you think is going to win this? I'm just looking through
here.
It's tough
to say because it's, you know.
Silence of the Lambs, that's a big popular movie with this crowd. QAM, hello.
George.
Yeah.
George, I got a good movie for you, man. My wife dragged me to this movie over the weekend.
Okay.
Woody Allen's new movie, Match Point.
Eee.
I didn't think I'd like it, George, but it's very good.
I can't really get into Woody Allen, and you know, after the pedophile years like I used to in the pre-pedophile years, you know?
I agree. But this is not your typical Woody Allen movie. It's got a lot of stuff going on. And
I don't know what that means, because, see, I like the typical Woody Allen movies like Annie Hall and Bananas and Sleepy.
Those are good movies.
See, I like those movies.
But you'll like this movie a lot. It's really, really good.
Can I wait for it to come on cable? Is that all right?
Absolutely.
All right.
Hey, George, one more thing.
Sure.
Has Neil ever discussed on air about moving to satellite, or is that never going to happen?
Yeah, he's discussed it on the air and off the air, and it's never going to happen. How's that?
You're the only show I listen to other than my satellite.
Well, what else is there?
Well, that's what I'm saying.
All right.
So keep it up.
We will. We'll keep it sideways for you. 8 till 2 on all sideways radio, WQAM. Well, you didn't think I was going to say hedonism again, did you?
Damn it, I just stole my line.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is 560 QAM.
Hank, I'm having a gay affair with Hank.
I'm a homo?
Your show, it's punishing. Play a record or something. Anything.
A record? They still make those.
I don't care. Play anything. Can't stand it. Just play anything. Can't stand it.
Well, I got the Peter King journalist here now. Is this Peter King?
Sure. That's right. I'm Peter King.
I know I gotta interview you. It's a big deal and stuff, but can I ask you one thing?
Go ahead.
Who are you?
What do you think I am, Noodle Brain? I'm a sport hole, see?
Look at that! The place is on fire! The whole thing's burning down! I would like to get it. It's worse than asshole in this house! So, there was a fire, and like that.
And we all died. I was you let me down, Josh. I know you're busy, looking for something, but they were just showing this, one of these models over here, and particularly see-through attire, and I wanted to find out who that was. They didn't have her name, under her boob, and I was going to ask you, but you were busy working. So thanks for nothing.
I bet she was hot.
She was really hot, and she was wearing a thong, and she was wearing, a paper-thin white top that was all wet and left nothing to the imagination. And I thought, who is that? Josh would know, but you weren't looking. So here's what we have for the list so far. We're going to start the show with this tomorrow and then add on. I think this is a good enough list to start with. What do you think? We got... And the question is going to be best movie ending. And we can also talk about the worst movie endings, too, since I'm writing them on the same piece of paper, since we only got, maybe 10 into that list. and we can analyze them each one at a time. That ought to kill the show. Ought to kill three of them, as a matter of fact. Best movie ending, Wicker Man, Braveheart, Dr. Strangelove, and, you know, I would love to stop hating and love the bomb. Wild Things, Shawshank Redemption, RoboCop, Sixth Sense. Can you pull that off? Like, say Sixth Sense five times.
Fast.
Yeah.
Sixth Sense, Sixth Sense, Sixth Sense, Sixth Sense.
Yeah, you're saying Sixth Sense. You're cheating. The Game, City of God, Gone with the Wind, Silence of the Lambs, and The Usual Suspects. I think it'll be between, like, Silence of the Lambs and The Usual Suspects. What do you think? Knowing this crowd.
I think Braveheart might surprise you, too.
That would surprise
me. A lot of people like
this
that.
This crowd. Really?
Yeah.
This crowd? You know, because it's a period piece, technically. All right, that's it.
I've never met anybody who didn't really like that movie a lot.
No, you're right.
You know what I'm saying?
Me either. It's 2 o'clock.